Bowl, NC State and Pittsburgh, teams that have known each other in bowl games before. Let's check in with Dr. Jerry Punch on the sideline.
Thank you very much, Michael. When the two teams met back in 1978, much of the pregame hype was about a Pittsburgh All-American, Hugh Green. But it was an NC State senior running back by the name of Ted Brown who stole the show that night. Brown rushed for 126 yards en route to a Wolfpack victory. Now, that could be an omen for tonight. If you look at what happened with NC State, seven games they won this year, they rushed for over 150 yards in those seven football games. More important, look at the four games they lost. They could not run the football. Less than 40 yards rushing in the four losing efforts. And remember, Pittsburgh only allowed about 41 yards rushing average in the final five games of the year. So that could be trouble for NC State. However, if NC State can't run the football, it could conjure up victory in the 1978 Tangerine Bowl for Wolfpack head coach Chuck Amato,
who was the defensive coordinator on that team. Jerry, come back to his alma mater and very successful, looking for a second 8-4 season in a row. He's age 55, and so is Walt Harris on the other side. Brought the Panthers to three bowl games in the last 5 years, since he's been the coach in Western PA. Beautiful downtown Orlando is advertised. Weather perfect. Nice and comfortable in the 70s by day, in the 50s by night, and clear the forecast for the season. Pittsburgh won the toss, deferred the option to the second half, so North Carolina State will get the ball first. Nick Watts will kick it for the Panthers. Pittsburgh in blue, and NC State in white, and we're underway in Orlando. Trouble with the handle, but Lamont Reed takes it to the 27-yard line. So here comes Phillip Rivers. We talked about him before. Impressive numbers. Second year started. Every game. Missed most of the last game for NC State with a toe injury. They say it's okay. He looks fine in warm-ups. Here are the starting lineups with him. Ray Robinson, 4 years. Solid all around. Coach Ray Jackson, dependable. Bryant Peterson early was the go-to guy, but Jericho Cottery has become that man in the offense. Willie Wright, the tight end. A big catch man this year with 40. He's a senior. They come out and put four wide. Team that throws it better than they run it. And the first toss is to Robinson. Beautiful hit by Corey Cox, who's all kinds of fired up. He's from Miami, so anytime he sets ground in the Sunshine State, look out for him. Let's show you this NC State offensive line. A couple of seniors playing their final game. Brown, the left guard. Keegan Weir, the right guard. Chris Homer, the most consistent of the offensive linemen.
On the defensive side of the ball, Brian Knight, 6'2", 240, a senior. He's the leader up front. Watch him come hard off the outside edge, trying to get the river.
8.5 sacks for the senior from Buffalo. Scholar athlete on this pick team. Rivers able to elude one rushing man and throw him downfield for Peterson. Incomplete. Corey Cox, second good defensive play of the night.
Job of the quarterback Phillip Rivers is staying with the receiver, and Peterson stays with the route because he knows that his quarterback has the arm strength. This is a long throw to make on the run for Phillip Rivers. You can see Peterson is not letting up, so you got to give Corey Cox a lot of credit. He also continued to give great effort and got just enough in the way of the receiver to bat it down.
Corey Cox, first play, bang, on a running play, boom, on a long pass. Nice looking defensive back starting the ball game. Number five, Corey Cox.
Needing to get to the 36 for a first down. Three in the pattern, and the throw for Sterling Hicks is incomplete. Never had a chance. Corey Cox defending on all three plays on that series.
The good news for Corey Cox is he's done a wonderful job. The bad news, they must have thought he was the weakest link on a football team, because a team doesn't come out and attack you like that unless they do, right, Kirk?
I don't know if I agree with that. Corey Cox has been getting it done all year for Pittsburgh, and that's kind of like an outfielder getting three putouts in the outfield.
Yeah.
The punt by Austin Herbert to Yogi Wrong, former walk-on receiver, says get out of the way. And good field position for the Panthers. He'll take over at their own 40. 32-yard kick brings David Priestley on the field in good field position. Fifth-year senior quarterback, kind of followed Walt Harris, Ohio State, to Pittsburgh, and is ending his career here tonight. What's happened in the backfield? Three freshman running backs, Marcus Furman, will get the start tonight because he started the last game. Lusaka Polite's the fullback.
Antonio Bryant goes on the ankle injury. Best receiver of the country last year. Not so this year. RJ Inglis led the conference in yards per catch. He is just as dangerous as Bryant in this offense right now. Furman gains just a yard. Good pursuit by that NC State defensive front. The offensive line for the Panthers. No seniors here. Rob Petitti, the freshman, has been very consistent throughout 2001. And Lee, let's check out the NC State defensive front four.
Number 48, Corey Smith, has caused six fumbles this year. That means he comes hard from the outside and tries to make a good play.
Anderson, six sacks on the other end, so 48 and 34. Also a good backup. They're solid on the end in Raleigh. Second and nine, Priestley to Bryant. First touch, lost the ball. It's ruled a fumble and out of bounds. That's a reception and a fumble not recovered by Pittsburgh. Third and 10 coming up. It was forced by J.J. Washington. We'll check him after we look at the backers. Linebackers for NC State, led by LeVar Fisher, number 44. And with the head coach, Chuck Amato, who spent years at Florida State, says LeVar Fisher reminds him of not only a Florida State linebacker, but a Derrick Brooks type. I didn't even know what he means. Washington starts because Marcus Hudson's out with a neck injury. Terrence Holt is Corey's brother. Ryan Williams, the senior, broke up nine passes this year. Third and 10, Priestley takes off and has the first down and more. Into Wolfpack territory at the 44. A pickup of 16.
Kirk, you and Mike, one thing about why do you think this quarterback's so wide open? I'll tell you why he is. When the quarterback drops back to pass, North Carolina State goes to man-for-man coverage all over the field. But they do not have anybody in the middle to spy David Priestley. If you notice everybody, Kirk, man-for-man, but no spy, Priestley makes a nice play.
One of the things is David Priestley, very good throw in the pocket, saw the man coverage, everybody covered, nobody left, and he picked up enough yards for first down. They bring Furman, the tailback, out as the receiver on the near side. So the three receivers set as the throw to Bryant is the first down. Antonio stays on his feet and brought down at the 27 by Terrence Holt. Antonio Bryant's ankle injury has been a concern. Hurt in the last game, played a little bit, then out. Nobody knew if he was going to play in the bowl game. Looks fine so far. Well, physically, he's one of the more gifted wide receivers in the country. Last year, he won the Biletnikoff. He's had some injuries to fight through this year. You can see how dangerous he is. He's a rangy receiver, 6'2", about 185, 190 pounds. And you can see the respect that North Carolina State has by running off the ball there.
A run for the freshman, Marcus Furman. Terrence Holt, the safety, coming down and runs the fourth. Joins Antonio Burnett on the tackle. I want you to remember number nine when we get in a kicking situation. He's one of the best kick blockers you'll ever see. College or pro. His brother's a superstar in the NFL. Corey, a wide receiver with the St. Louis Rams. As Terrence walked on at NC State and has impacted special teams more than most players do in their career.
Starting to make a name for himself here. Certainly here at Long State.
This is second and 10. Four in the pattern. Incomplete for R.J. Inglis. In man coverage with Ryan Williams on that side, and that's where Pittsburgh's been looking tonight.
Interesting. We had one of Pittsburgh's games early in the year, and we saw him play Miami on a Thursday night. And this is when they were running the no-huddle offense. David Priestley never quite bought in and never really felt comfortable with the no-huddle offense. Middle of the year, they decided to go back to Walt Harris's offense that he's been running for years, more balanced. You rely more on the running game, and David Priestley's numbers have gone up because he's more natural in this kind of offense.
They converted third and 10 with a Priestley scramble earlier in this drive. Beat the clock. Four in the pattern. With time. Caught by Inglis. First down. To the nine. First and goal. Panthers. 18 yards, and the pass yards are coming in big chunks in this first drive.
This is very good pass protection. Watson Tickle set back, gives Priestley plenty of time, but the reason why this play is successful, number 35, George Anderson, was trying to cover up with old English, your man. They couldn't cover him. They had a linebacker on an outside line, wide receiver, and boy, that was a great read by Priestley. That's why their play worked. That play worked. Miss Madsen.
First and goal, ball touching the tennis, first and goal. Bryant and Inglis to this side. and incomplete as there was confusion on the combination route and pressure on the quarterback free throw. Kirk, you mentioned it. Let's go back and set the Pittsburgh offensive story. At 1-5, the offense has switched from the no huddle to a more conventional offense. Really, the offense Walt has run most of his career.
And it's the reason David Priestley followed Walt Harris from Ohio State to Pittsburgh. David Priestley is very honest with you. He'll be the first one to tell you that he just really couldn't get comfortable with the no-huddle offense. And now you can see him. He looks at ease, and he's more suited to this style of offense.
Four receivers, pressure from State, and incomplete for Bryant. You know, one of the problems with Antonio Bryant, this is so much practice time, the small stuff, the adjustments, and the timing. Last time Pittsburgh played a game was a month ago, November 24th.
But Antonio Bryant's such a natural athlete. He can get into the flow of the ball game. But you made a great point about that. It's not Antonio Bryant you worry about. It's the quarterback Priestley and his timing together.
David Priestley yesterday mentioned to us that he said that, you know, Bryant's an exceptional player. He'll make adjustments. But for me, the timing of not having him run reps in practice, that's the thing that they hurt and miss.
Play 10 of the drive is third and goal. The blitz up the middle. Priestley saw it, but couldn't complete the pass. And a field goal opportunity coming for the Panthers. We reminded you about Terran Colt.
Mm-hmm.
The most impressive stat to me. The opponents against NC State this year, you see all the blocks. They've had 5 blocks. Opponents are 6 of 17 kicking field goals. So if he doesn't get it, he changes the game a little bit.
Yep. Look how excited he gets, too. You see him? I mean, this is big right here. He knows he's got a shot.
Nick Locks, 11 of 17, had 2 blocks this year.
Watch the push right in here.
Holt is number 9. He got up there, didn't get a piece, and Locks connects. 27-yard field goal from the senior from Findlay, Ohio. 10-play drive gives the Panthers 3. And the lead at the 2001 Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl. Third bowl game of the 2001 postseason. Pittsburgh leading North Carolina State 3-0 after an 11-play, 50-yard drive that was capped off by the locked field goal. Priestley, in addition to the 33 yards passing, had a nice scramble of 16 yards to keep the drive alive. Two freshmen, Lamont Reed and Greg Golden, back to receive. Here comes Golden. Seeking, finding open space, lowered his shoulder to bang the kicker and take it down to the 40. Greg is happy with his performance. Let's check the back 7 for Pittsburgh, anchored by Gerald Hayes. 51 is a first-team All-Big East performer out of Paterson, New Jersey. He's a junior, Williams a senior. Here's their secondary.
We've already seen what Torrey Cox can do, one of the best corners in the Big East, and he'll be tested all night. Ramon Walker is really the leader. The quarterback back there in charge of coming up and run support, and also keep an eye on 14 Mark. Outstanding with his intelligence.
To Jericho Cochrane, who got hit by Ponco. Did a great job of holding on, but lost the yard.
That was a nice cue.
Thank you very much.
He was nice out. I'll thank him for getting
his style in down there. We got to say one thing about North Carolina State. First 4 plays, they've come out, they've decided to try to throw the football against Pittsburgh. One of the things that North Carolina State has done when they've been able to win football games is they've been able to run the ball. 7 wins that they've had, they've averaged 154 yards rushing, and their 4 losses, 38 yards rushing. So they've got to be able to run with Ray Robinson tonight.
Here is Robinson. He's stopped by Lewis Moore.
No, you're killing him with the juice, too. You really put the old smudge on Robinson. The poor kid didn't have a chance.
What do you got for third down?
I told you that Ray Robinson was one of the best-looking football players. Did you ever?
Nobody knew it.
Yep. Now, this is why. If here's the situation. Nobody touched him. He's right side of the offensive line. Keenan Rear, the right tackle, stepped to the outside and left a hole in there. And boom, there's a linebacker blitz. Now, anybody want to name a person who's going to look terrible or good right now? Here's the guy that's going to get the ball down here at the bottom.
Okay.
Look for Cochrane on 3rd and long. I think Rivers is going to throw the ball on the top of the screen.
3rd and 15, little Duncan Robinson.
Huh?
snuffed out by Lewis Moore. So Torrey Cox made three defensive plays. Mark Ponco one, Lewis Moore two. And those six plays have meant nothing for the NC State offense.
Pittsburgh defense right now playing at a great level of emotion. And that's something that Paul Rhodes, their defensive coordinator, has to see. They typically will play with great effort. They started off very good tonight.
Yogi Rock will let this one go. It bounced forward for the punter, Austin Herbert. And a long field for Pittsburgh. They'll start from the NC State 18. We have a timeout with 8:25 to go. And Antonio Bryant, sophomore year, won the Biletnikoff Award. Best receiver in the country. This year, 42 catches, 9 touchdowns on the field when you come back.
Washington, the Culligan Holiday Bowl, Friday, December 28th on ESPN.
There is Antonio Bryant, a junior who might be playing his final game in collegiate football. He has the ability to go to the NFL. The question is everything else around Antonio Bryant. Spectacular 2000, as we said, Biletnikoff Award winner, but injured his ankle very early in this season, and at the back end, injured the other ankle, and just hasn't had it together except for the key stretch when Pittsburgh turned the season around. That running play is stopped by Brian Jameson, the strong side linebacker, pickup of a couple, and here's Jerry Punt.
Michael, you mentioned Bryant's injury. It's the third play of the season then, returning a punt against East Tennessee State. He inverted his left ankle. He missed the rest of that football game, South Florida, and came back and played against Miami. Through two games from the end of the year, he got kicked in the heel on the right side, and then against UAB in the finale early in the game, he inverted his right ankle. So left ankle early, right ankle late, but he's on the field tonight.
Not an invert, I think.
After a pickup of two, it's second and eight. Another run for the true freshman, Marcus Furman, lost his footing, third and 10, coming up.
The thing about Antonio Bryant, it's been an ongoing battle as far as he and Walt Harris and trying to stay positive. This is a year where their whole team was tested. The character of this football team was tested. When you talk to Walt Harris, he will tell you in the last five games that Antonio Bryant has been sensational from an attitude standpoint. But the thing about Bryant is, he means well. He has good intentions, good character, but in the middle of a hostile situation, his temperament becomes very volatile, and sometimes he lets his emotions get the best of him.
Third and 10, three receivers is briefly thrown to England. Fourth down, kick it away.
Well, watch English come out of the backfield, number 84 right there. What they do, and the reason they do this, they try to pick off. You notice right there, they picked off the defensive back, Victor Stevens. That's called a rub-off, but on illegal play, which it was, is called a kickoff. But the guy dropped the football. Should have had that. It was right in.
Wide open, good call to get a matchup with the receiver on his safety. You gotta convert that.
Sophomore punter, Andy Lee. Good rush by State. Lee able to get it away. 37-yard kick is almost fumbled by Cockery. Kept it alive and got it to the 49-yard line. Jericho Cockery playing hot potato with the pigskin. Well, ACC fans, we have college hoop for you tomorrow night on ESPN. Number 2 Maryland. Saw them at Cole against Illinois, and they were great. They have to go down to Norman to take on Oklahoma. Hollis Price. Number 2 takes on number 21. Both teams are 8-1. We've got it for you tomorrow on ESPN. What a game that Duke and Kentucky
was. Was that great or what?
Wow, that's terrific.
That's the best basketball game I've seen regular season in.
Oh, unreal. I think Dickie V would agree, boy. He was in March form. Cranked up, excited, getting after it, December style.
First and 10 for NC State from the 48. Rivers pass is complete to the tight end, Willie Wright. Took him across midfield, down at the 48-yard line. Tackled by Ramon Walker, the free safety from Akron.
I'm not saying they can't win by just throwing, but they've had 7 plays. They've thrown the ball 6 times. I mentioned this earlier, there's 7 wins. They've been able to run the football a number of times. 36 times, 153 yards. Compared to the 4 losses, only 25 rushes. As you can see, the rushing yards are down at 38 yards a game.
Ray Robinson swirling through the middle of the defensive
defensive front for Pittsburgh, a yard and a half shy of the first down.
I like what Chuck Amato has done right here, though, Kirk and Mike. What he's done is he used an unbalanced line and a flanker, giving him the impression that they're going to the wide field, and now he's come back twice to the short field. That was the best run he's had, and the reason why Pittsburgh overmoved the defense too far, and he's adding gas automatically to the short side. Nice automatic play there.
They'll move Robinson offset as the lone back and flex Peterson out to the bottom of the screen. The third, a yard and a half. They get it through the air with Ryan Peterson. Taken down to the 35, a pickup of 9 yards. Solid completion for Peterson, who added a lot of strength this year in the offseason. This is the area that Phillip Rivers has improved the most. He doesn't have that home run ball anymore with Corn Robinson, so he's had to be able to spread it around. Here they give him the option to throw or to run. You can tell he's looking at the defense, trying to figure out how many people they have committed to the alignment. Once he sees they're committed to the run, he decides to stick with the pass, and he has an easy conversion to Peterson.
Toss Robinson has some blocking here. Ray Robinson hit hard at the 26. Yards shy of the first down. That's the first team all Big East performer, middle linebacker Gerald Hayes.
Robinson's tough runner. Leads the team in receiving. Physical for a guy that's 5'10", 200 pounds. One of the best lifters on the team. Upper body strength, he's a tough guy to bring down. Had a great year.
He made two or three really tough hard runs against Florida State. Yeah, oh, yeah. Tallahassee was tough to win that ball game.
Second of the yard, three down in the minds of some. Whip, Hayes got to Rivers. Well, Gerald Hayes, who had 6.5 sacks in his middle linebacker spot, tells you they like to bring him in blitz situations. Did it there.
The interesting thing about NC State this year is most defenses have decided to sit back and play them in zone. This is a defense, Pittsburgh, that relies on blitzing and playing a lot of man coverage. So coming in, the question was, would they blitz or would they sit back and play zone? In the early going, they're taking some chances and doing what they do best, and they're blitzing the linebacker.
Big Comer, the right tackle, missed the block on that. He should have just slid in there. It wasn't an overload blitz. It was a mistake by the right tackle, Big Comer, for why he got the Rivers.
Second and one to third and seven. Rivers finds some space to throw. Robinson. That move forward got him across the line for the first down. That's the 21.
I think at the end of the night, the people in the country will say Ray Robinson looks like one of the best all-around backs they haven't seen much in college football. I think he's perfect for the Los Angeles Rams offense. I mean, he reminds me of a Marshall Faulk kid. He can catch the ball, he can run it, he can flank her out. Boy, I tell you what, he's a sensational football player.
Very good matchup there. That time they had Hayes, who blitzed the play before, one-on-one with Robinson.
Robinson up the middle.
Ooh, it's more. Play like a wishbone to bring him down.
I don't mean the Oklahoma bone either.
North Carolina State this season, 7-4. We were there for the opening win over Indiana, then at SMU. Then the loss to North Carolina. Things got rocky a little bit. A couple of ACC losses, 3-3. The line in the sand was drawn. The win over Virginia at Duke, the signature win in the history of the league. The first team to win at Florida State. Then they almost beat another top 10 team in Maryland. Rivers is down at the bottom of your screen. Olin Hanum, the backup quarterback, is taking the snap and running option. To the 15, really just a quarterback draw, no option back with him. So Olin Hanum, the senior, who had to play a lot in the final game of the season against Ohio because of an injury to Rivers, in there and a little bit of a wrinkle that we've seen a few times this year. Terrific athlete. You'll see him covering kickoffs tonight. He'll be the wedge buster. He'll get out there and give you everything he's got. And he is a football player that you'd love to have on your team. One of these guys, you find a way to get him on the field. Even though he's a quarterback, now he's lined up at the top of the screen.
Had two receptions this year. Rivers looked his way. Actually, it's the other receiver on that side. It was too high and incomplete. It'll bring up fourth down. I think there's some confusion here, and
surprising play call. Third and short. You can see it. Once Rivers makes the throw here, you can't tell if he's frustrated with himself or if he's frustrated with the wide receivers for not making the right adjustment to the route.
33-yard field goal try. Adam Kiker, 4.0, great point average. Pretty darn good field goal percentage this year as well. And he ties the game at 3. As a sophomore, has evened the game at 3. A couple of long drives have led to field goals. David Priestley gets his turn for Pittsburgh after this.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of the 2001 Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl is presented by Visit Florida. For hot Florida vacation deals, go to flausa.com. And in part by Capital One, who asks, what's in your wallet?
Holiday lights adorn downtown Orlando. We're even at 3. The Pittsburgh defense came up with a sack on second and one that meant the touchdown intentions of Phillip Rivers quickly turned to a field goal drive. Adam Kiker closed it out from 32 yards.
It seems like both teams are trying out a few new things that they hadn't worked out before, and I'll bet you when they get back down to the second, third quarter, right onto the ball game, they'll go back to the basic principles of running the football, play action, and trying to beat the other football team physically. It looks like they're trying to trick the other team.
Yeah. Well, they got kind of tail each other out. North Carolina State that last try.
Yeah.
At least they went back to the running game.
Yeah, a little bit more.
Torrey Cox from the goal line. To the 24-yard line. Special team tackle for Thomas Horn. And here's Dr. Jerry Punk with a guest.
Thank you, Michael. It's my pleasure to visit with the Honorable Lieutenant Governor of the State of Florida, Frank Brogan. And Lieutenant Governor, how important are events like this, the Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl, to tourism in Central Florida?
Well, the Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl is incredibly important to Florida. As you might imagine, Jerry, we have suffered, as is the nation, in the wake of 9/11. We're going to host 5 bowl games in the Sunshine State this year, this being the first of those 5. We had 71 million visitors to our state last year. And they can see by tonight's crowd and the great event that we want people to come back and stay in the Sunshine State.
You'll hold with me a second. We'll go back upstairs for the play and come back down. Michael?
Okay, Doc. First and 10 from the 25. And Priestley starts first option covered and comes back for the completion to Bryant. Out of bounds at the 32.
Go ahead, Jerry. Lieutenant Governor, this state has been so good to college football over the years, not only for the collegiate teams that play here, but for the postseason bowl games. You mentioned the bowl games are going to be played here, and not only a number in this state, but one more on this field here coming up in a few weeks on New Year's Day.
Indeed. Again, 5 bowl games here in the state of Florida, and Florida, of course, is a hotbed, of course, Jerry, at every level, and certainly collegiate level. So we are proud of these bowl games, and it gives people an opportunity to come to the Sunshine State and see what a wonderful place we are to live and to visit.
Wonderful hospitality. Thank you, sir. Let's go back upstairs to Michael.
Thank you, Jerry, and our thanks to the Lieutenant Governor as well, Lou Stocka Polite with the carry. He'll be about a yard short of the first down, 3rd and 1 coming up.
Speaking of football games, there also is a game in late January here, an All-Star Classic right here in Orlando in Citrus Bowl. The two coaches are going to be Lindy Infante and Coach Barry Switzer.
Oh, that'll be great.
That's a great game, isn't it?
Yeah, Gridiron Classic, right?
Gridiron, yeah. It's going to be here.
Lee will be here. We'll have that for you on our family of networks. 3rd and 1.5. Rod Rutherford in there at quarterback. And he stops shy of the first down. They bring in Rutherford for backup in some short yardage situations. And George Anderson was very aware that the quarterback might keep it. And Pittsburgh will not.
Great job here of just knowing the tendencies. When Rutherford goes in, there's a chance that he's going to keep the ball on an option. And this time, North Carolina's defense is ready for him. George Anderson, kind of an unorthodox style all year long. All he does is just make plays. He asked the coaches, is it his speed, his size, his count? I don't know, guys. He just makes, he's always there to make a big play, and he did there.
Andy Lee, he's going to see some heat, it looks like.
He did last time, too.
They spent so much time on special teams. Lee did a nice job getting rid of that one, and a great move as well. Wow. Jericho Cottery just lets it bounce, and it's down at the 16. Fabulous kick of 51 yards for Lee. Well, Saturday at 7 Eastern on ESPN, SportsCenter will remember the legends who left us in 2001. Dale Earnhardt, Corey Stringer, Sheedy Wheeler, Willie Stargell, Al McGuire, among them. So many people who made a great impact in sports, no longer with us. Listen to 2001 SportsCenter Remembers at 7 Eastern on Saturday. Somebody who meant a lot to the Florida Citrus Sports Organization as well, Charlie McClendon, the old LSU coach, who passed away last month. Also in the talks of many down here as the bowl season gets started. Rivers pass is complete to Willie Wright, the tight end, out to the 35. A 17-yard first down pickup for the senior from Greensboro.
There's been some that have criticized Phillip Rivers and North Carolina State's offense this year for not having the big play the way they did last year with Court Robinson. And talking to him, it's pretty simple why they're not having an opportunity. Defenses are keeping everything in front of them. Tonight's one of the first games that they've had all year where the defense is challenging them in man coverage. They'll have a shot tonight at some big plays in the pass game.
Gone to Robinson. Good pass popping over there. Gained about a yard or so. Dante Spencer, the corner, stuck his head in run defense. Gerald Hayes closed it out as Week blows out the first 15 minutes. Offenses look pretty good. Looks like they can move it. I don't think we're going to get to 100 points. Second quarter of the Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl. We're in the Florida Citrus Bowl in Orlando. Mike Tirico, Lee Corso, Kirk Herbstreit, Dr. Jerry Punt. Second and nine for State. Very well-played quarter for two teams that have had almost 4.5 weeks off. No penalties, no turnovers. Brian Peterson. Face mask flag should come in there, and there is the first flag of the game after a first down at the 45. Ramon Walker, the junior from Ohio. I think it was a 5-yarder. As always in bowl games, a neutral conference not represented by either team. Officiates, Rogers Redding in the Southeastern Conference crew. We'll mark off that 5, and we'll check what happened in the first 15 minutes on game track.
Phillip Rivers is starting to get into sync more and more. He's now 8 of 11. Great throw there to get North Carolina State's offense going.
David Priestley and R.J. English right in the hands for a long touchdown pass that was not shown in that game day track.
And Pittsburgh's defense has handled the run so far pretty effectively. Rivers, the sophomore from Alabama. This is option. That is Ray Robinson. And only a couple of yards there. Ryan Smith came off the defensive end and made the tackle.
They're giving Phillip Rivers the opportunity to get to the line of scrimmage, look it over, and based on their alignment, because they're in a lot of 3 and 4 wide receiver looks, look at Pitt's defense, find out if they have 6 or 7, and what you always hear people talk about, the box. And once he makes that assessment, he then will call either a run or a pass. But it's all predicated upon Pitt's alignment defensively.
Mark Conco, the strong safety, one of the key read men. He's at the bottom of the screen, showing like he's coming. He's dropping off in coverage. As Rivers had no room to step up and throw. Look at that.
Wow.
You rarely see that many bodies on a pile in a pass situation.
Now, on the Pitt side of the football, when you're playing a team like the Rivers and North Carolina State that does that, you must skip your defenses up. That time, Pittsburgh started out with look like a 7-man front. Before you know it, there was 14 guys in the box.
Yep.
But they did it late. If you're going to put the quarterback as quick as Rivers is, you got to blitz them late, and you got to change late because he's so smart, right, Kirk?
That's exactly right. You can see.
Yeah.
They're seeing the same thing that we're seeing upstairs, and now they're starting to teach him by showing certain things and then backing out and just trying to play with him if he's going to make calls at the line of scrimmage.
There you go.
Little pickup game here.
See that right there?
Cat mouse.
There you go. There, that's the point right there.
Third and 8. Heat coming. Paco nearly had him. Rivers put it up top. Incomplete for Cotter. One of the things that's happening, guys, is Phillip has no space to throw the football.
Yep.
And again, this is something new to North Carolina State. Seeing a defense that is going to blitz. Ponto, the safety, comes from the side, just misses him. He buys enough time, puts the ball. If he puts a little bit more air underneath that, easier said from up here, but we don't have 8 or 9 guys chasing us, a little bit more air, and that's a touchdown. They want these one-on-one matchups for the big play.
Here, Purifoy was coming up the middle. Third punt for Austin Herbert. Try to get Pittsburgh inside the 20. Yogi Rock will let it hit, and it bounces into the end zone for a touchdown. Good news is it's a 48-yard kick. Bad news is it nets only 28. But full week of football and some great action on ESPN and ESPN2. And tomorrow at a special time, 5:30 Eastern, the Paladins of Furman, the Grizzlies of Montana, play for the national championship in Chattanooga. Furman won the title in 88. Montana, national champions in 95. As you see, Napier and Humphrey will be key in the game. But Ron Franklin, Mike Gottfried, and Adrian Carson will have for you tomorrow at 5:30 Eastern. And a timeout taken by Priestley as NC State was playing a little cat and mouse of its own defensively. 2:13 gone by. Second quarter, all even at three. Pittsburgh opened the season with a win over East Tennessee State, 1-AA team, then lost five in a row, including what some have termed the most embarrassing loss in the history of the program to South Florida at home. After the BC game, it was time to decide if you were in or not in. And as you see, most of the team got in, and they won their final five games. You talk to the folks at Pittsburgh, and they talk about what happened that week of the Temple game, after the Boston College game. Walt Harris, in no uncertain terms, said, "Hey guys, if you want to be a part of this team, show up on Monday ready to work. If not, turn in your uniform. We'll move on without you." That plus the philosophy change changed the tenor of this season. The first down run that picks up 4 or 5 yards really for Marcus Furman, the true freshman.
I think the loss to South Florida, second game of the year, was devastating to the psyche of this team. So many high expectations. So many people thought this team was going to make a run. Remember everybody talking about the preseason? Hey, the Miami and Pittsburgh game, look out. That could be an upset waiting. People were talking about 9 or 10 wins. And when they lost that game, I think they spiraled down emotionally and really showed a lot of character for them to be able to recover and win their final five.
Second and 4, R.J. English. Lays the block. Furman cut back in that lane. 5 yards, first down to the 31. Lee.
Following point with Kirk, I couldn't agree with more. And let me give you the reasons why that statement is correct. Also, in the middle of the season, they played all their good football teams.
Yeah.
And that's why they got beat. The other teams were better than them. If it's that last part of the season, 4 of the 5 football teams they played were not very good football teams.
But the one that I agree with,
Virginia
Tech. The one that opens your eyes is Virginia Tech. Oh. They held Virginia Tech to 15 rushing yards, ran for 150. As you saw Virginia Tech play Miami, you know, it's a good football team. On first and 10, here is the senior Priestley, loading up for AB. Bryant couldn't get there. Bryant Williams step for step with the junior.
Well, I didn't think Bryant would be able to catch up to it, but I think he did. I think he did, and I think you're going to see Bryan Williams, number 29, make a sensational play and just get a hand on the football to knock it away from Bryant, who's, again, one of the best receivers out there, and that's great coverage. He did a good job of coming down with his arm. From there on the replay, you could say, well, that's pass interference, but they're caught that to rip down. Great play by Bryan Williams.
Williams is also a great special teams player as well. Promised his mother, Bobby, he would finish his education. She's a minister. He's a trash talker at times. But Mom has control. The freshman Furman getting his balance. Terrific spin move on his way to the 38-yard line. How about that, huh? That was going to be a gain of 3. It turned out to be a gain of 3-2.
One of the main reasons why that play was also very good was the timing of the call. We had pass, 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 a nice little screen. He just runs to the left right there. Lineman fall down right there. But the fact is that the English got up and ran. The key part about this whole football play, I think, was the call. Marcus Furman made a good run and a good finish. That's a good finish. I know that's a good play. But the call was perfect timing. Pass, 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 screen.
First and 10 from the 37. Priestley. Another release that Raymond quickly out of the backfield. You saw Furman came out with his helmet needing adjustment. So the other freshman back, Kirkley, who started a bunch of the season, comes in, gets 22 yards, and he says, keep working on that helmet. I got you down here.
We just reviewed their season. We talked about what happened early in the year. I think a lot of what happened was the offense. This is Walt Harris' offense. He's throwing the ball down the field to the receivers. He's hitting the back of the ball, dumping it there on the screen, finding Kirkley out of the backfield.
picks up big yards. When Pitt's at their best, they're running the ball, they're throwing screens, they're very, very versatile, and they're tough to defend.
When they're doing the best, the offensive line is playing the best.
Pittsburgh in the red zone from the 15, looking to take the lead. Quickly.
Lucky if he got back to the line of scrimmage. Bryant Jameson started the tackle party along with Patrick Thomas, freshman backup linebacker from Miami.
And Pittsburgh brings back every offensive lineman they have in that starting unit. And that, to me, is where the whole football team starts. If you can control the line of scrimmage by running the football, I think then everything else falls in place.
Probably the most improved area on their team this year from start to finish. Five guys across the front. More experience now. And playing with more continuity up front.
Second and 10. Priestley. Bryant. Down. Pittsburgh. Pass complete for number 80 and 10 to the left. Good for 6 points in the Panthers.
The reason why that play works is Antonio Bryant has got man-for-man coverage in the secondary, and they watch, they'll bring a glad man underneath him, but then all of a sudden, number 32, Julius Patterson falls down, and Bryant just makes a great catch. But the key to that play was, why was he so wide open? It was because the undercut caused one-on-one coverage. Patterson against Bryant, and forget about it at that time.
And it's not a cover man. It's not a corner. It's the rover there. And it's not the matchup that State wanted, but the matchup that Pittsburgh got.
Lock adds the extra point, and the Panthers take the lead.
This is a complete mismatch. And again, look at Walt Harris as an offensive coordinator. He knew how to find a matchup to get it, and that's the receiver, Antonio Bryant, going up against Julius Patterson one-on-one. And when you get one-on-one with Patterson and Bryant, it's going to be a touchdown. And Pittsburgh right now, I think, feeling a little bit more confident now, up seven.
Generous play.
Well, 2-1, the ratio of offensive yards thus far. State can make something happen on this drop. Short kickoff. Good field position coming for Lamont Reed. 30, 40, and pushed down to 44. Really tackled. Nice form, too, by Nick Watts.
Mm-hmm.
30-yard return. Go back for a unique look at the touchdown. It's a great shot from the blimp, and you're going to see motion here from English and come back. I think there's a little confusion with Patterson, because Patterson then is going to be ISO one-on-one with Antonio Bryant. Typically with Antonio Bryant, if you're going to leave him in single coverage, you're going to leave him with a corner, not a safety. And I think that motion, bringing him back and then back across, I think may have confused the secondary. And again, one-on-one matchup, that's like Randy Moss getting an opportunity one-on-one in the NFL. You got to capitalize, and they did.
Short field, 55-yard drive. Ray Robinson from the 45.
3 to the 48-yard line. One thing about this Pittsburgh defense, they hit you hard. Gerald Hayes again. That middle linebacker has been called a lot here in our first 20 minutes.
And we talked a lot about Bruce Lee and the change of offense winning the ball game, but their defense improved to a fact where they only averaged giving up one touchdown a game the last 5 wins. And that, my friend, is a very, very good defensive football team. And you all you need to score maybe 14 and you're in? Ha, not bad.
Not bad at all.
Jericho Cottery, sophomore, played high school basketball against Phillip Rivers in Alabama. Pass deflected and incomplete.
This is for Brian Peterson underneath. We'll have third down coming up here in the Florida Citrus Bowl. That's the name of the stadium that's hosting the Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl. As a matter of fact, the Citrus Bowl is played on New Year's Day. Used to be the Tangerine Bowl.
Right.
And this building used to be known as the Tangerine Bowl and is now the Citrus Bowl. You got that?
Yes, we did.
Yeah, so this game used to be the Citrus Bowl. You know, this game was just a Tangerine. Actually, it used to be the Micron PC Bowl down
there. Beautiful downtown Orlando.
I'm going to keep on testing. We're here, they're here, in timeout, North Carolina State. NC State fans are ready for Christmas with their school colors.
Got to pull the flag.
I don't know what those guys are ready for, but we're ready for a commercial.
This month, AT&T Broadband delivers the movies you want on in-demand pay-per-view. Dr. Doolittle 2.
Oh!
The Grinch. Swordfish. Spy Kids. All this month on in-demand pay-per-view from AT&T Broadband.
Have plenty of power this holiday season with Duracell Alkaline Batteries from Menards. Choose from multi-packs of copper top batteries in five popular sizes. On sale, just $3.99 a pack. Get extra power for high-drain items like CD players, toys, and digital equipment with Duracell Ultra Batteries, the most powerful Duracell ever. Multi-packs are only $5.99. Power up your holiday with savings from Menards.
Player develops a sonar radar for the position of the hoop. He always knows where it is. Buzzy, roll the film.
We've spent a lot of time talking about the offense, but look at the defense. 7.4 points allowed the last five games. All the numbers have gotten better, and that bottom line really says more than anything else of it. Three offensive touchdowns in the last five games.
Actually, only two, if you count the one where Pittsburgh's on offense fumbled on their own two-yard line, and then the defense gave up a touchdown. They've been playing well all year. The problem is the offense is turning the ball over so much in the early part of the year that it puts the defense in some bad positions. Third and six. Pick rushes five. Receiver fell, and the pass is incomplete. Brian Peterson tried to make a cut and slip. We've seen a few players slide on the area outside the hash marks tonight. Punting time for the Wolfpack.
Pittsburgh doing a good job of confusing the North Carolina State offense. They're not just sitting in man. They're not just sitting back in soft zone coverage, mixing up their coverage quite a bit. Therefore, the receiver and the quarterback can't find any rhythm.
Fourth punt in five possessions. Yogi Roth lets the Austin Herbert kick bounce again. It was kept in play and downed at the one. Terrific covering job by the long snapper, Danny Young.
Kept it from going across the goal line.
Juan Dixon, one of the supreme performers in the ACC. Number 2 Maryland takes on number 21 Oklahoma on the road tomorrow at 96 Pacific on ESPN. Gary Williams' team got to the Final Four last year. They haven't missed a beat this year. They look pretty solid. Chance to see them with Holden and Wilcox. Talented front line. They might be back to the Final Four this year. Long field for the Panthers. They run with the fullback, Lusaka Polite. And a sophomore out of Woodland Hills, one of those great football-playing high schools in the Pittsburgh area. Gained a couple of yards. Such a rich, fertile football area, Western PA. And now Pittsburgh has really made recruiting inroads at the stadium, the program, and their facility.
And Penn State's losing. That's the best thing that's ever happened to that kid, that guy Harris right there. His fraternal's not going to a bowl game.
Chance to have more success in state.
When you can control your state, or at least be on an even footing, makes recruiting much different. Priestley in trouble. Used his feet to get away. Got a nice block to gain another yard. He's going to be just shy of the first down. Roosevelt finds the freshman receiver with the big block. And here's Doc.
Guys, not good news for NC State on the sidelines. Their All-American linebacker, LeVar Fisher, is on the locker room. X-ray just came out a moment ago. He has a broken left arm, a non-displaced fracture. Let me show you on the left arm, right below the elbow, is a fracture of the radius. That's a large bone in the forearm, just below the elbow, non-displaced fracture, but he's done for the night.
All right, Jerry, and LeVar Fisher, a senior, who came back and was so worried about injuries in his senior season, and was injured, had concerns with his knee injury. He's able to play through that, but not this one. Rod Rutherford, back in at quarterback. He's the running short yardage quarterback. Let's see where the spot is. It looks like it's enough for a Pittsburgh first down.
Mitch and Fisher being concerned about getting injured and making a decision to come back for his senior year. there's so many young men out there who make the decision as either redshirt sophomores and juniors to decide to declare and leave or to have that decision to stay. If you make the decision to stay, don't look back. If you sit there and you worry about getting injured, you're better off just declaring and leaving. So many guys come back, and then they play not to get hurt, and they end up getting hurt.
Russell took out enough for the first down. Priestley back to the quarterback in a 10-3 game. Looking long. Antonio Bryant reeled it in at the 38 and a marker down. He was working on J.J. Washington, the sophomore quarterback who's in for the injured Marcus Hudson.
Antonio Bryant, and I'm telling you right now, will not be playing at Pitt next year. He's going to play in the National Football League for this one thing. Kirk, watch his adjustment to the ball with his head right here. It's right over the receiver's hands. Watch. Perfect concentration. I think that is an NFL-type play, and I think he's coming out based on the fact, number one, he gets hurt a lot. He has a problem with the coaching. Why mess around and have another ankle injury when that kid can come out and play football in the National Football?
Physically, he's a top five, top ten type of pick in the NFL. Mentally, that's the thing that's been holding him back. You're probably right. He's probably going to come out and decide to go play in the NFL.
I think so.
The guy has incredible ability. The moral of the story tonight, North Carolina State probably doesn't want to leave him in one-on-one situations too often.
Dietrich Gills was the all-time Pittsburgh leading receiver. Bryant now holds that mark. That was his longest catch of the year, a 49-yarder. Priestley uses the middle. It's Bryant again. And he spins to the 26-yard line, away from D'Antonio Burnett's tackle. And the other linebacker, Brian Jamison, is slow to get up after finishing the play. So they've lost LeVar Fisher to a broken arm, the senior weak side linebacker. Now the senior strong side linebacker, Jamison, is injured.
Not a good thing. Something you like to see from the wide receiver who wants to make the jump to the next level is not to be a prima donna and just catch the ball outside on one-on-one. You need to be able to show the toughness to get inside where the safeties and linebackers are, especially when you're a tall, rangy receiver. And there, he has shown that ability throughout his career, and there you get a chance to see it firsthand.
And I think also one of the reasons why he's going to the National Football League is the fact that he started to play not only for Pitt, but for himself in the middle of the season. And everybody starts saying, you want to play? Show us something. I'll guarantee you he has showed him something in the last five games. And tonight also.
Roger Pollard, 39, Lee, a sophomore from Miami, Florida, has come in at linebacker. They also have Pat Thomas, 47, a freshman from Miami, Florida. Young in the linebacking core right now because of the injury. Priestley still gets pressure and is sacked by Pollard first. Second sack of the year. One thing Chuck Amato has done in terms of turning this program around is get down here in Florida and recruit. He controls South Florida with Bobby Bowden, Florida State, so well. He's kept all of his ties. He's still very active recruiting down there. And these are some of the kids who are the beneficiaries of that work. Pollard back to the bench because there are five DBs now on second and 16. Four receivers out, double pass, Furman. To the 27, here's Jerry with an update.
Well, news not real good here in Wolfpack land on this side of the field. Brian Jamison, senior strong side linebacker, just came limping off the field a moment ago. Just look at Brian out of Swedesboro, New Jersey. And Jamie called the Wolfpack trainer, working on his left thigh and hip area. Severe pain for Jamison. They've already lost LeVar Fisher. They're going to try to pad Jamison's left thigh. It's a deep bruise just above the knee. A lot of spasm, a lot of discomfort. But they're going to try to get him back on the field. Michael?
All right, Jay. Two tough players to lose. And the future of the program is now the linebacking area. Priestley looking for a seventh straight completion. Has it with Lamar Slade, the junior, out of bounds at the 11. And NC State is on the ropes right here.
Lamar Slade.
It is absolutely unfair to put any of the guys in white jerseys against Antonio Bryant or any of these receivers the way they're running. Watch this nice cut. I'm telling you, Walt Harris is an offensive genius in the passing game that he understands and knows. And that was Lamar Shade. Was that right?
Yes, it was.
I don't care if it's Bryant. I don't care if it's Shade. You notice the precision? That's extremely well-coached football team with the number two receiver to do as well as the number one receiver.
Nice throw also by Priestley to put it on the money and on time to give Slade that chance.
First and 10 from the 11. Priestley throw to English. To the 5-yard line. What a good, solid group of receivers here, Kirk, with Bryant, the junior. Slade also a junior. English is a senior who led the Big East in yards per game this year.
And they have another young one coming up, Roosevelt Bynes, who can fly. Maybe the most exciting of the bunch. So they have a great group, and I think the offense going back to the old style has helped all of them get more involved in this system.
Second and 5 for a first down. 5.5 for a touchdown. Priestley. Ooh, intercepted and dropped. Oh, a chance for Pat Thomas on the deflection, but he couldn't scoop it up.
Just trying a little pop pass to the back.
After 8 completions in a row, Chuck Amato's team desperately needed that ninth one, not to be incomplete, but intercepted.
Well, the defense did their job. They had an opportunity here for the turnover, and right there, you could see the ball gets freed from his arms and touches the surface. The defense put a little bit more pressure. Thunder Dan Burnett got in there and made a big hit to get David Priestley back and feeling a little bit more heat.
Pittsburgh's taking a timeout. It's second. They have one remaining. Pittsburgh is dominating the game offensively. They're looking to take a 2-touchdown. There's a bright orange monster over the stadium tonight. The monster.com blimp is providing us with some nice views. Inside the Florida Citrus Bowl as we watch the 2001 Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl. Pittsburgh leading 10-3, looking to extend that lead as they have 3rd and 4 for the first down, 5 for the touchdown.
You see this game being dominated right now by Pittsburgh. 231 yards of total offense.
They've brought Jamison back in the game with that bruise that Jerry talked about.
Pat him up and get him out there. Senior, last game. He's got one-on-one at the bottom with Antonio Bryant again.
Got a movement. Flag came down. They snapped it immediately once NC State came into the neutral zone. And see, here's the interesting thing. From the 5, this will be half the distance to the goal if it's offside. It's not the walk-off for the first down. If it's against NC State.
Have a dead ball foul. Offside against the defense. Half the distance to the goal. Still third down.
You know, in other situations, in 3rd and 4, that's great. You got the first down. Here you still have 3rd and a couple. That's just the game. 2nd penalty, 1 first down. Extremely well played for this long layup.
It's to the bottom again. If he wants it, he has Antonio Bryant in the face.
Priestley, deep that way, throw that way, Bryant, touchdown.
Well, he's red hot, and North Carolina State is continuing to lead. Defensive backs isolated here. Instead of going to the fade to the corner, it's a fade comeback. Nice throw by Priestley, throwing the ball on time, and a good job of using his body by Antonio Bryant to keep the defender away from him. It's his 2nd score of the night.
Somebody came to play tonight.
He sure did.
Nick Lodge for the extra point. That one wasn't pretty, but it counts just the same.
Antonio Bryant is playing a sensational football game. They got one-on-one coverage on him. There's nobody in America to cover him, much less North Carolina State. That was a perfect pass to the outside. Good. Now watch Priestley, who's very, very excited. Priestley, Bryant, together, they're winning this game, and they're gone after this one, both of them together.
Creating. Last time they won a game in the postseason. Priestley, a terrific couple of drives. And how about the last 2 drives? That man extraordinaire, Marty Aronoff, points out 80 yards, and that one 98 yards. What? Down to 1-3. And it's taken by Greg Golden. He's had a couple of nice returns, and Golden breaks free! Greg Golden, fun race for Torrey Cox. Touchdown! Down there with 4 minutes left, but it wasn't needed. More of that South Florida speed. Golden, the true freshman from St. Thomas Aquinas in Fort Lauderdale. Extra point is added by Piker. That is the first return for a kickoff for the Wolfpack in 5 years since Alvis Whitted did it against Florida State back in September of 96.
Well, Mike, you mentioned a low kick, and anytime it's a low kick, it's going to give the return team an opportunity to set up some blocks. And right here, you're going to see a key block right there, right in the middle of the screen from right to left. I think it was Contra Jackson pushing Purifoy out of the way and giving Golden a huge running lane right up the middle.
Greg Golden's got that super South Florida speed. The one thing I liked about this, they've set this play up three times. It's exactly the same place they've run three times before. Twice he's made it back at least to 40 to 45, and that time all the way. So you know what I like about that? Chuck O'Mata learned that at Florida State. You work hard on little things like this. If your football team's not playing well offensively, or if they're not playing well defensively, you can sneak up on people and score and beat them with special teams. That's a Florida State trait that Chuck O'Mata brought to him from North Carolina State.
You know, Chuck O'Mata was a Bobby Bowden assistant for so long, for 18 seasons, and he always talks about how Bobby gave him a lot of responsibility. And in return, Chuck O'Mata has taken so much of the Florida State mindset and applied it to this team. There's always been good talent at NC State, but that's just taking it to a next level because of that speed.
I think you guys talked about recruiting the state of Florida, and most especially going down to Miami. I think it's besides speed, I think that's an attitude that he's recruiting. And you can see in the last 2 years that North Carolina State is starting to take on that Florida State kind of demeanor, that swagger that you see in Tallahassee every single year.
Torrey Cox from Miami's Northwestern High School. He wants to return one. He's got an opening up the middle, and he's got to the 30. The mind was going faster than the feet could. Mind always going fast with Chris Fowler. And here he is in the studio. Hello, CF.
Oh, the master of the segue. Mike, coming up at halftime, some mixed news, much of it bad for Alabama as they get set for the Independence Bowl. We'll feature the hits of the 2001 season, plus some college hoops scores and highlights, several Big East teams in action. Terry Bowden, Mark May join me for SportsCenter in game next year.
All right, Chris, Pittsburgh basketball team 10-1. They beat Ohio State last night. Marcus Furman, right side. Stopped by the last line of defense across midfield at the 49. And Furman is shaken up. Julius Patterson beaten for the earlier touchdown by Antonio Bryant. Saved the touchdown there, and they'll look at the true freshman.
Marcus Freshman, 5'8", 175. Marcus Furman, he has a nice play here because of the fact is you'll notice the right tackle. The right tackle, Brian Matt Morgan, comes around the right side and blocks to the outside. I've seen this play more and more, Mike. Mm-hmm. I've seen it in NFL more and more, where they pull those tackles around the outside, put them on the corners, and allow those running backs to run behind them. The St. Louis Rams, my favorite team, are the ones that do that more than anybody. And I tell you what, the colleges are not doing it more than ever.
you see, especially in this Walt Harris offense.
Yep.
So many pro-style plays that Furman gets up.
But he always refers to it as a West Coast offense. The big block by the tackle, also a huge block by R.J. English. That's one of the things that the Pittsburgh offense demands from their wide receivers. Not only go out and make a big catch, but watch English here take out Holt. And he's opened it right up. He took away Pat Thomas and Terrence Holt by coming down and having that crack block.
Well, he is a receiver who might not have the best speed out there, but they have told R.J. English special teams blocking the little things are going to be the things that are going to keep you on an NFL roster.
He's incredibly athletic.
Yeah. After a pickup of 21, here's Kirkley, the other tailback. 9.5 yards. R.J. English has had a couple of knee surgeries, and Jerry can detail it far better than we can with the types of knee surgeries he's had. He's had a battle rehab a couple of times, a former walk-on, but he's retained his speed, and he is someone who emerged. As a matter of fact, I mentioned earlier, he led the Big East in receiving yards per game 5 straight years. Murphy, Grimm the last 2 years, Antonio Bryant, this year R.J. English. Pittsburgh has had the Big East leading receiver in average yards per game. Second and one. Briefly. Pocket collapse. And he goes down. That's Terrence Martin, sophomore from Virginia. Closed in and closed it down.
Yeah. David Priestley trying to go to the well one too many times. Again, had an opportunity off to the left to try to get the ball thrown out one-on-one to Antonio Bryant, who beat his man for a touchdown. If they would have given him just another split second, Priestley was looking out to the left against Brian Williams. Brian is, again, deep with not any support behind Brian Williams. That's just, again, very easy throw. This time they walk the safety over to help against Bryant.
Lamont Reed, the freshman's out there in coverage on Bryant, and the whistles blow on this one. That sack, by the way, by Terrence Martin was the first for a player who was in junior college last year and has walked right into a starting role this season.
They think he could be a superstar in the future.
The game against the up there, the 25 clock fired, 5-yard penalty, still third down.
6'4", 290. He is incredibly quick, potential to be a dominating player, only a sophomore. I think that's the thing that's helped North Carolina State's defense overall. Three junior college players, and they're getting production from all three of them. Much more speed, much more depth on the front line this year for North Carolina State.
That's a late penalty, Kirk, with a 3rd and 16.
Another 3rd and 21.
Matt Morgan, the right tackle.
And a dead ball, false start against the offense. Got and tight snap, 5-yard penalty, still third down.
Some of the teams are starting to do this on defense now throughout the country. After watching what Tennessee did against the University of Florida with their interior linemen, they kept a lot of them up in two-point stances and moved them around. They didn't even know where they were going to put, much less the Florida team. And you know what, Kirk? That really hurt Florida. And you know, this is what Tennessee defense has done to other people now.
This 3rd and 21, up the middle of the rush, the pass out early and incomplete. That pressure came from Terrence Chapman, who is drawing with Priestley.
Where Priestley gets in trouble when he lets the emotions get the best of him. He's also going to get beat up. But that, he has to just let that go and come off the field.
That can get hit.
A little forearm in the back.
He's got to walk away from that. Sometimes lets his emotions get the best of him, too. When he plays under control, he's a great player.
State sniffing at Andy Lee. 10 white shirts look like 20 right there right now. Roughing or running into the kicker, probably roughing, as the fair catch was called by Cockery at the 25.
You think that was roughing?
Oh, yeah, I agree with him. Not say why.
Oh, they called it running into
it. It looked like he was trying to slow up.
Now, let's check it out. All in the eyes of the beholder. In my opinion, when you saw him start, He looked like he was holding up, but he didn't lower his body.
That's foul.
There you go.
Oh, they did call
it.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yep. He called
that.
15-yard penalty for the automatic first down.
And let me tell you why he was right in that situation, Mike was. The fact is, when I watched the guy start to hold up, usually his head comes up. That guy's head was down, and his body was going like a bullet and hit the man. Watch him right here.
That's Lamont Reed, the freshman.
See that? Yeah. Yep. Good call.
When the kicker's in that prone position, The referee's going to call that a 15-yarder. Try to protect the kickers as much as possible. That little bump into the guy on the way by is a 5-yard.
Yeah. Job. The thing that caught me there right there, you're right, his head was down, but he just barely touched it.
Right.
It wasn't real physical.
So from 4th and 21 to 1st and 10, Pittsburgh at the State 45. Incomplete and behind, tight end Chris Wilson. That could be a very big penalty in the game. NC State had momentum and was going to get the ball back, and at worst would have been 17-10 at halftime.
It's going to be interesting to watch the mind games now. I think North Carolina State saw they got a reaction from pushing on Priestley a little bit, and if they can get him to think more about them and talking trash back and forth, now they got him out of his game a little bit, and that becomes a mind game between Priestley and the defense of North Carolina State.
Second and 10, nobody's open. Priestley's waiting for a receiver to work for him. And there's that guy, Lamar Slade, at the 36, yards shy of the first down. One timeout left with a turning clock, and Priestley will stop it at 34. Third and a yard coming up here. You're right about the heat. It's getting hotter on the quarterback.
Lamar Slade right here at 6'4", 205, is physical enough to run through the receiver. And that's Bryant right there.
That's great.
That's right. That's good. They look, you know what? They look so much alike from up here. And I just looked at the numbers quickly, but they're right. Lamar Slade, 6'4", 205. The one thing I would do here, I don't care if it's third and one or third and two, I'd make sure that it was not one man only on Antonio Bryant. Even if he was on the sideline, I'd have a guy over there watching.
I think that's going to be an adjustment you'll see him make in the second half. You got
to
get Holt,
somebody,
or Patterson, move them over to allow the corners. The corners just can't survive the second half one-on-one.
Right.
Well, let's talk about the first half. Bryant had 7 catches, 101 yards, and a couple of touchdowns for Pittsburgh.
Well, it's been an opportunity for Antonio Bryant to show America that, number one, he's healthy, he's able to play, and this is what happens when you try to defend him one-on-one. And Priestley, give him some credit, because he's been putting the ball right on the numbers. They're in sync tonight. One-on-one opportunities. He's been able to get 2 touchdowns tonight in mismatch situations, and what will be, again, something to watch in the second half, whether or not Chuck Amato elects to sit back and play the same defense or make some adjustments to try to slow down Antonio Brown.
Third in the yard, Polite runs. Woo, Saka Polite. To the 1-yard line and out of bounds. A man who gained 77 yards all year had 35 on that run.
The interesting thing about that call, we're talking about passing this, passing that, everybody else, it's third and one to give him a nice drive play.
Look at that.
Look at the hole in this, because everybody's playing pass defense.
Yep.
And it's third and one. The game of football has changed so much, it's impossible for me to believe that any football team would line up on third and one and play pass defense. But you know what? You almost have to the way these guys throw the football around.
Timeout, State.
Well, that's a brilliant call by Walhead.
NC State will have one timeout left, and you go back to the momentum, 17-10 to score. Chuck Amato's team's going to get the ball, but Lamont Reed, the freshman, gets the roughing the kicker penalty. Pitt gets it back, and they could take a 2 touchdown lead to the locker room.
But it's something that North Carolina State, they're going to go back and look at themselves at halftime and think, what have we done? But they've got to be able to stay in this game. All it takes is one play to get back in. We saw the kickoff return, got them right back in this game. If they give this touchdown up, it's going to be up to Chuck Amato to get the troops in at halftime and say, hey, we've been here before. Let's come back out in the second half and make the adjustment.
And look at the yardage difference. 298 yards given up by Amato's defense in the first half. His offense has only 69 yards. You add all the numbers up there.
Whew. Seems like we've been talking a lot about Antonio Bryant, the Pittsburgh offense, but the defense is playing well. You got Rutherford now in your center.
Rutherford, the running quarterback, who has 6 touchdowns on the year. No timeouts here. They run with Rutherford, and he is in.
extended.
So the sophomore Rod Rutherford gets his seventh rushing touchdown on the season.
Well, when he comes into the game, you know it's either a sneak or an option.
Nick Watt, the extra point. Flags are down. Andy Lee is his holder. Kirk Johnson is snapper. And we're going to have to do this one again.
That's a foul. False start. Offense movement in the offensive line prior to the 5-yard penalty.
So we'll re-kick it here. Three consecutive possessions with a touchdown for Pittsburgh, and that one was kept alive by Lamont Reed. And the roughing the kicker. Lots of 25-yard extra point. Still good. And the Panthers lead by 14.
Like the situation is fourth down and 95 yards to go. So North Carolina State is going to do a nice thing. They're going to try to get back in the ball game, trying to block a kick from the outside out. Florida State's out. But watch Lamont Reed right here as he goes in through. He tries to slow down, but he keeps his head down in a position where it gives the perception to the official that not only was the kicker in a bad position, but that he was trying to hurt the kicker. If I think, if he'd have said what you did, Mike, if he went down and put his head up, I think it would have been a 5-yard penalty, and they wouldn't have scored that thing.
Reed, of course, familiar to not only North Carolina State fans, but fans of the game, for making that tackle against Maryland, catching up to the guy and making the tackle and causing the fumble at about, what, the half-yard line?
Mm-hmm.
It looked like to secure a victory until Maryland came back to win that game.
Touchdown in the final minute. NC State played back-to-back games, Kirk, against top 10 teams. Florida State, the winning Tallahassee, and then Maryland was ranked 9th and 10th in the polls. A great game that went down to the final minute.
If I didn't know better, just look at these two football teams. It looked like to me the white team, North Carolina State, expected to be here and expected to win, and the Pitt team and the blue team is going to show these guys they deserve to be here.
Another line drive kick. This one to the right side of the formation. There's Golden, who had a touchdown for 90 yards last time. He is met at the 25. Good special team kick by Brandon Williams, the linebacker. Well, we've seen the pictures from above the Florida Citrus Bowl tonight. Brought to us by Monster.com's East Coast Limp, Trump. I don't know if you realize that Trump was the name of the East Coast Limp.
One good thing about that, psychologically, isn't it wonderful to be able to talk to a college football game and have a blimp over the stadium again?
Mm-hmm.
Remember?
Yeah,
it wasn't a couple of six to 8 weeks ago, right?
Yep.
I mean, it was dangerous. You could not have a blimp anywhere near. God bless America, man.
Here. In the 25, Olin Hannum came in and handed it to Coach Gray Jackson. Get out to the 43, and now with 6 seconds left, at least you have a chance to take a shot down the field. You just put one up for grabs. Interesting that Rivers is on the bench here for the final couple of plays. Olin Hannum in a quarterback. I don't know if the toe injury is bothering Rivers. Didn't seem that way. They just go inside handoff with Jackson. He's going to kick down the field. He banged into the umpire. It was okay. And the half is over. Antonio Bryant had 155 yards in the Insight.com Bowl last year. He has 101 at the break of the Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl and two touchdowns. That's the margin. Pitt 24, NC State 10. Pitt gets the ball to start the second half, but that can't begin until Chris Fowler gets done. Go ahead, Chris.
All right, Mike, as the Antonio Bryant contract drive continues from the past five games, mark NC State's special teams, seize momentum, and then give it right back. That roughing the punter call was just huge against him.
And that did. That really cost him at least the score in this game, at least the lead in this game. But if you look back at this game, it comes down to kick coverage. The University of Pittsburgh has to start covering kicks. North Carolina State's done an outstanding job in their kick return unit. But here's the key to this game on the other side of the ball. You cannot single cover Antonio Bryant. In the second half, look for North Carolina State to double cover him. But watch for the counter move out of the University of Pittsburgh. They'll put him in motion.
Yeah, the Pitt's defense has the great game plan. Phillip Rivers not very mobile. They're blitzing, getting bodies around him. He's got to hit some deep balls in the second half.
We talked pregame. That's an underrated defense that had had their fill of hearing about Phillip Rivers all week. Coming up on SportsCenter Endgame, Terry Bowden has a chance to show us what John Saunders has thought about hockey. Free NHL highlights. We'll also preview the Las Vegas Bowl. USC's defense came on strong. They'll take on the Utes in Vegas. That's ahead.
Unscripted with Chris Connelly. Weekdays at 5 on ESPN. Thinking about Viagra? Now available in a free six-pill sample pack.
Six? That's my number.
So get in the driver's seat and ask about the free Viagra sample pack.
Get to your doctor for a checkup and find out if a free sample of Viagra is right for you.
For more information, race over to Viagra.com.
Took on a bully.
I want a rematch.
No, everybody wants him to be a hero.
Been waiting for someone to drop that shirt.
But first, he's got to learn how.
Then let's begin.
This Christmas, you better watch out.
What are you, like 12?
Ho, ho, ho. You better not cry.
Oh.
You better look out.
Ooh.
Tim Allen, Jim Belushi.
Easy windmill.
Joe Somebody.
I want to psych the guy out.
You talking to me?
Ready BG tomorrow. Only in theaters.
SportsCenter Endgame.
Well, the Pittsburgh Panthers behind seven catches in the first half for Antonio Bryant, a 14-point lead over the Wolfpack in the Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl. A week from tonight, Alabama will take on Iowa State in the Independence Bowl. Some comings and goings for the Crimson Tide. Santonio Beard, who had been arrested for DUI, welcomed back to the fold by Dennis Franchione as their fine running back. But Antonio Carter, best wide receiver, out of that game, along with Dante Ellington on offensive tackle, a reserve tackle, Lannis Baxley, and fullback Marvin Brown. Those four guys not in that ball game. For Georgia Tech, Joe Burns, by far their best running back, the ACC's leader in rushing touchdowns this year with 14, academically ineligible for the Jackets-Seattle bowl game against Stanford. So this is the time of year when there are always guys, for one reason or another, are bowl casualties, Mark.
And I think for Alabama, it's really going to hurt their passing game with Antonio Carter. He's their second leading receiver on the team with 32 receptions. But you're getting back Santonio Beard, and I think this is key for the offense. In the last game against Auburn, 199 yards on the ground. He's the hot hand. He's their second leading rusher of this football team in only eight games, and he averages a whopping 8.2 yards per carry. So a running back like that, you've got to get on the football field.
And it happened to Joe Burns, too, but you got to look at the big picture. It used to be that a senior athlete could quit going to class and still play in the bowl game. The NCAA made it so you had to pass a certain amount of hours to play. It really brought back the student athlete, but it's hard to monitor. I could make them go to class. I just couldn't make them pass the final. Look at last year, Florida State playing for a championship. Snoop Minnis flunked out, couldn't play.
Every year, there are key guys who missed the bowl games who changed the complexion of the game. Well, it hasn't quite created the heat of Notre Dame or Georgia Tech, obviously, but Vanderbilt has a coaching vacancy for now. As early as Monday, that vacancy could be filled by Bobby Johnson. He's been the head coach at 1AA Furman for the last 8 years, been a successful coach at that level, three straight playoff appearances, including an appearance in the 1AA championship game tomorrow against Montana in the state of Tennessee, coincidentally. a game being played in Chattanooga, and Johnson, until after that game, doesn't want to even talk about the Vanderbilt job. With a preview of tomorrow's game, here's Adrian Karsten.
Furman knows the field awfully well. After all, Tennessee Chattanooga is in their conference, and they've played on this gridiron within the past month. However, their head coach, Bobby Johnson, reminds us that, yeah, they may know the field well, but Montana knows this game. After all, it was just a year ago on this field that they lost the national championship, the Grizzlies did, against Georgia Southern by only 2 points. Now, Lewis Ivory, Furman's all-star running back, is not 100%. 3 weeks ago in the first round of the playoffs, he took a shot to the outside of his left knee against Western Kentucky on the game-winning drive. Well, he claims now that he doesn't have to play in this game, much less play well, in order for Furman to win the national championship.
Well, I think over the last 2 weeks, my teammates have proven that they can win without me, but I think I'll be an added help if I am able to play and be effective.
We are here to crown a national champion, and both head coaches agree it's appropriate we do it here on the field without a computer.
To me, they need, Division I really needs to look at what we're doing. Somebody's going to walk out of here the national champion, and there'll be no committee, no newspaper guy, and no selection board is going to say, well, they were, they should have, they could have, they would have. This is a national championship, and it's the way it should be.
You know, there's a lot of distance between Missoula, Montana, and Greenville, South Carolina. The point is, this is the first time these two teams have ever met. They don't know a lot about each other. Therefore, the first few series will tell us a lot about who is going to win the national championship. We'll see you tomorrow evening at 5:30 Eastern Time.
All right, Adrian, thank you. Antonio Bryant was questionable for this ball game. Questionable now describes Wolfpack defense against him. Panthers up by 14.
Right now, Florida's beaches seem a little whiter. Our thrill rides more chilling. Our history that much richer. Our food a bit tastier. Our hotels never more welcoming. Could it possibly be because of all the money you'll save? Visit FLAUSA.com to learn about all the hot Florida vacation deals. FLAUSA.
Nice bandsaw.
An angle grinder.
Huh. Whoa, pretty heavy duty.
Check it out.
Whoa, what's that, 10 ounces or?
10.5. Oh. It's got steak.
Can I borrow it?
You know how to use one of those?
Yeah.
Oh. Tender marinated carne asada steak and lots of it. The steak grilled stuffed burrito from Taco Bell. It's the heavy duty, portable way to think outside the bun.
Back to SportsCenter Endgame. Quick hockey update now, and here's some trends for you. Philadelphia just can't handle the Dallas Stars. Winless in the last eight, very mediocre team at home, while Dallas on the road has been dominant, 7-0-1 the last eight games. All these things point to a Dallas victory. Well, we'll see. Keith Primo will keep the puck alive out front. Terry, we call this a pass to Marty Murray. Puts the biscuit in the basket, as John Saunders might say.
I've
got sharp blades on. Martin Rysinski, one-timer, home, ties it at one for the Stars. Dallas then tries to clear it. Theory keeps it alive, sends it to the goal, and Primo there to bang on the rebound with the backhand. Second intermission, the Flyers, a 2-1 lead. And now gone to the third period, just about 12 minutes to play, and the Flyers trying to snap those trends we talk about with a home ice victory over Dallas. Now to college basketball. Jim Boeheim, prostate surgery, missed a couple of games. Welcome back tonight as they take on South Florida. Deshaun Williams off the three, misses, but Hakeem Warrick slamming back the rebound. Syracuse up in the early going. And James Steele finds Williams with the cross-court pass, knocks down the triple. Cuse beginning to pull away here, double-digit lead. And Warrick Shumpert, he knocks down the three, and Syracuse trying to fight off a rally by the Bulls. See, it's a nice look down low at Shumpert and Syracuse after back-to-back losses to NC State and Georgia Tech, now with a 12-point win over South Florida to get its 10th win of the season. The Hoyas only lost to Georgia this year, but they really haven't played a lot of good competition. They've been blowing people out until tonight when Virginia leads them by 10. Virginia is trying to make it 24 straight non-conference wins. Cincinnati against UL Monroe, 54-28 at halftime as the Bearcats look to make it 9 in a row. Tennessee and Louisville was a thriller here. Tie game at 70. Volunteers in the lane. Marcus Hayslett gets the short bucket. Volunteers by two. Then Reese Gaines takes on the entire Tennessee team. Drops short of the line. Knocks down the triple. Cardinals up by one. The Volunteers. Hayslip again gets the pass, turn around, off the iron, and Louisville, in a thriller, knocks off their border state rival, Rick Pitino, cool and calm as he ups the record to 8-1. A couple other games tonight. St. John's has had a battle from St. Francis, New York. They trailed much of this game now inside of 7.5, and the Red Storm have a 6-point lead. We'll come back with more at halftime. The big hits of 2001. Golden, with the kickoff return, cut the lead to 7. Panthers had a late touchdown. It's 24-10.
It's a
nice talking.
You don't like it?
No, it's great.
You know, you're always going on and on about
it. I know.
As they said, it's the thought that counts.
Hey, look, I really like it. It's the nicest.
Unwrap a Jaguar S-Type, now for just $4.99 per month.
I want to be a golfer.
Coming up in our college bowl season here on ESPN, we'll be showing you the plays of the year divided up by type. Stay with us here. That's the theme tonight, the 2001 hits of the year.
It's about that time. Boy band on the radio channel. How that sound? It's about that time.
big hitters in college football featured there. Roy Williams and Mike Doss and the big security guard on the guy in the tidy whitey. I mean, we saw Deshaun Foster, by the way, dishing out some of the hits as an offensive player.
You cannot be timid and play this game. I don't care what position you play. If you step on that field, eventually you're going to get pasted. I don't know about you, Mark. You got girls, but after seeing that video, my four-year-old son, Terry Jr., he's starting piano tomorrow.
I'll tell you, I have girls, but girls can hit, too. I'll tell you that. But I'll tell you, watching that, I just sat here and got flashback. My neck started hurting again. I said, oh, did I do that 20 years ago when I was in college? But there's one thing about it. The kids today are bigger, stronger, and faster. And hits like that, I'm glad I'm retired.
And there ought to be an asterisk, too, because we've showed you a few just blatant cheap shots that are way outside of the rules. And those don't need to, you know, be glorified and lumped in with the good, clean hits as well. At halftime, Pittsburgh, a 2-touchdown lead over the Wolfpack. And they figure out a way to cover Mr. Bryant. We'll find out.
I grill with George.
America's favorite grill is America's favorite gift. Get a George Foreman lean, mean, fat reducing grilling machine for someone you love.
Hey, that's my line.
Those on the credit card.
Yeah, why?
Do you know what those interest charges are going to do to us?
Don't worry. I used our new Capital One No Hassle card.
Fed up with exploding credit card rates.
To the neighbors!
With Capital One's new No Hassle Platinum card, you get one low fixed rate and none of the hassle.
Gotta tell Steve and Laura about Capital One.
What's in your wallet?
There are places on Earth where the chase never ends, where the meat smells an insatiable appetite, and the laboratory is a limitless well with free to hunt. Pushing back the frontiers of science, engineering, and technology. North Carolina State University. Knowledge is the prey.
Pete Carroll in Orlando tonight watching his son Brennan, who plays for Pittsburgh, his USC team get set for the Sega Sports Las Vegas Bowl against Utah. Trojans defense got it cranked up second half of the season. They come off a win against their rival. Utah comes off a heartbreaking loss to their rival, BYU. Could be a low-scoring game, huh?
It really could be. The USC, they were going to be a good offensive team. Norm Chow, they hired the highest-paid coach in the country to run that offense. Remember what he did for Phillip Rivers at North Carolina State last year? They never gelled. It was their defense that averaged 18.5 points a game giving up. Their defense, they can put pressure on the quarterback with their defensive line. They're one of the most athletic secondaries in the country. Look at Antoine Simmons' interception right here. Great interception. And if they keep the bowl game close, they have a kicker, David Davis. Remember that name? He was 15 of 17 on field goals. He can kick the ball. You know, Norm Chow isn't the personality of this team. I think about it, you know, I think with Pete Carroll being a defensive coordinator in the NFL, his personality has come out in this football team.
Maybe his personnel, but I think they're going to have a lot of problem stopping Damian Hunter, the running back for Utah. He's done a fantastic job of running the ball, particularly in between the tackles. He's not a small guy, 5'11", 225, but he can power through the holes. He's dynamic of following the counter blockers. Follow the big hogs up front. That's what you do. Now run through tackles. Has quick feet, can make quick decisions down the field to play, and he can pick up blockers. But what he has to do here, don't look around. Take that ball in there and score. You got to have eyes to get to the goal line, and that's what's going to put pressure on the defense for USC.
The game is Christmas Day on ABC. Speaking of Christmas, you guys have a great holiday season. We'll see you back here as Bowl Week resumes after Christmas. Mike and the gang, we'll have the second half. When you come back, we showed you Antonio Bryant's other touchdown. Here's his second touchdown. Panthers lead it by 14 when the second half comes up after this.
Menards has thousands of great last-minute gift ideas. Look at these great gifts, all with a $5 rebate. Choose from a drill, angle grinder, sander, or jigsaw from Tool Shop, all at the incredible low price of $9.97 each. This bench grinder is 1988. Or how about this handy chef's torch or cordless hot glue gun from Burns-O-Matic? Only $9.99 each, all after $5 rebate. And a Menard gift card always makes a great gift.
In the spirit of giving, ABC Family is celebrating more than just one day of Christmas. We're celebrating the 25 days of Christmas.
Wonderful!
25 days of Christmas specials. 25 days of Christmas movies. The 25 days of Christmas, because one day is never enough. December 1st through the 25th on ABC Family.
Cinderella's Castle, the Magic Kingdom. 100 years of magic to celebration at the Walt Disney World Resort. Not too far away from the Citrus Bowl here at Orlando, the site of the Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl. Pick 24, NC State 10, set for the second half with Lee and Kirk and Doc. What do you think, boys? Look ahead.
First of all, I think there's imperative that North Carolina State come out smoking in the second half. I think they got to go back offensively and have some balance. Defensively, got to put the pressure, because if they let Pitt get too far ahead of them, they won't catch it.
Two things for North Carolina State to do. They can't get away from running the football with Ray Robinson. That's something that, you're only down 14, you have two quarters to go. Stick with your game plan.
Right.
Get the ball downfield with Phillip Rivers if you have some one-on-one opportunities and protect him better. They didn't really do a good job of that. And then on defense, if you don't put a safety behind a corner in one-on-one coverage, you're crazy to leave him in one-on-one opportunities.
Pittsburgh gets the ball first to start this second half, looking for its first bowl win since back in the John Hancock Bowl, 1989. Story top from the goal line. It's a tough one to return. A well-placed kickoff. And he slides down to the 14. There's the first special teams play.
Right.
As NC State's Andre Maddox made the catch. Those of you just tuning in, here's game track. Tell you what happened in this game. Priestley's been solid. 14 of 23, including a stretch where he completed 9 of 10. Two touchdowns as well.
Antonio Bryant has been sensational. Every time they put one-on-one coverage, nobody on the North Carolina State team can cover him one-on-one.
It looked like North Carolina State caught a break when Golden returned this 90-yard kickoff return for a touchdown, but another special team blunder for the Wolfpack caused them a touchdown right before the half to give Pittsburgh the 14-point lead.
You got it. And the kicker kept the drive alive, late to the score. Here's Pittsburgh. Starting with Luke Polite, who had a big run before. He's got out to the 20. Here's Jerry to tell you what happened with State at the break.
Guys, in my 14 years of college football, I've never been in a locker room like what I saw at halftime with Chuck Amato. No team sections, no offense or defense. Chuck set everyone down, stood in the middle, and talked for about 8.5 minutes. And you see Chuck in the locker room a moment ago. He said, it's not about X's and O's, guys. It's about being embarrassed on national television. It's about wanting, it's desire. It's not the same football team to beat Florida State. Now you know why these guys tumbled Virginia Tech. We are not getting it done. This first series, second half, we've got to stop them. We've got to come out and play physical Wolfpack football. An emotional halftime by Chuck Amato.
Good stuff, Doc. Second and five. Here is Polite. First down. Loose sucker Polite looking across the 25, and they're not able to get Pittsburgh off the field in the first three plays of this drive.
When you saw the injury to Fisher and then to Jamison, although Jamison is back out on the field playing injured, he's not at 100%, you saw Pittsburgh's offense change. They went more to running the football to the inside with Polite and also getting the ball to Kirkley and Furman. They're going to try to attack these linebackers because they don't have, they're not at 100% if they're out there, and they got some young linebackers that they're trying to take advantage of.
Polite, the fullback, has run it the first few times in this drive. Make it first three. They've taken it out to the 29. Jerry, what about Walt Harris going in?
Well, Michael, get accustomed to seeing Lusaka, Polite, and company, because at halftime, Walt Harris said, we want to come out in the second half and establish the run game. We want to be physical up front. We thought we could control the line of scrimmage with our offensive thrust, and we want to come out in the third and fourth quarter, run the big guy, Polite, and company. But expect quite a bit of a run game coming here in the third quarter, at least, from Walt Harris's Pitt Panthers.
Polite out, Raymond Kirkley in, and Marcus Furman, the freshman back who was so good early on tonight, had a long run as well. He's on the sideline, but he doesn't have his helmet in hand. Usually when a guy doesn't have his helmet, means he may not have been cleared to be out there on the field. Priestley, 3 steps short of England. Yard shy of the first down. Terry Polk, the junior, made the tackle.
Where Pittsburgh right now is having to make a decision defensively. When North Carolina State when North Carolina State defensively, rather, gets into position to either blitz and sit back in zone, Walt Harris and the offense are doing a good job of sitting back in a man situation. They're making him pay for that with a big play. And then in zone, they're finding open pockets and picking up valuable yardage.
Big play, heart and desire play. If State wants to stem this drive right here. And they'll go play pass. One receiver out for English. He's covered. Puts it up there anyway. And he caught it at the 30. And a flag to boot for a face mask. Well, English was covered on the little quick hit. He moves it down the field. And he moves the chains with a pickup of 36 plus the flag.
You talk about a play like R.J. English does here that takes the wind right out of you. It's to fake the ball on third and one and then go over the top against man-for-man coverage. The reason why that play worked is they called it at a perfect time.
We have a face mask foul against the defense. 5-yard penalty added into the run. First down.
To keep your eye on number 84, R.J. English. As he breaks down here, right to this point, he is covered. But now he keeps running, makes a nice adjustment to the football. But the key point about this whole thing is, why is he one-on-one coverage there? Because it's third and one, and they expected to see a run. Very good call by Walt Harris.
From the 23, Kirkley minus three. Pat Thomas, 47, started. Antonio Burnett and Corey Smith aided. Again, Thomas is playing because of the injury to LeVar Fisher. First-team All-American. National, that's up in the league here. First team All-American linebacker, broken arm, his great NC State career done. The all-time leading tackler in the history of NC State football. Came back this year, was concerned about a knee injury or something else happening. The knee did get hurt. He had to wait a long night to find out if it was a torn ACL. He prayed, found out it wasn't, was able to keep playing, didn't miss much time. The arm injury tonight ends his career. Saka Polite. I'm going to tell you about some hard running from the sophomore from Pittsburgh, PA.
Where you get into trouble, you get back, you're so concerned with all these great receivers that the back can hurt you. Now once they dump it out here, listen to this hit.
Bryant Jameson's giving you everything. I don't know if he's going to be able to walk tomorrow, but number 20 linebacker right here. How'd that one feel?
Wow. It's third and a couple. Four receivers, one back. They passed in this situation before. Deflected and incomplete. The opportunity now after Corey Smith, the man who forced a half dozen fumbles this year, deflected that. Opportunity briefly hobbled a bit to get the kick blocking strength of NC State perhaps to make another momentum swing in this game.
Walt Harris' strategy has been perfect here. Balanced offense. The key thing also, he's taken 5 minutes off of the clock.
Aaron Cole, great kick blocker, comes after this 33-yarder for Locke. He got submarined on his way up. And the kick was good. Very well done by special teams for Pittsburgh tonight. Terrence Holt is great up in the air, adjusting to the ball, lays out all the time, even in practice, trying to block kicks. He hasn't gotten in the head of Nick Locke tonight. Look at number 9 go all the way up. Come all the way down hard, too. Story's brothers made a name for himself on special teams, but tonight, Pittsburgh special teams has helped out. Leading 17.
As backyards go, Florida's is tough to beat. History in one corner, fishing shacks in another, with just about everything in between. And whether it's rocket ships or roller coasters, there's never been a better time to enjoy Florida. Especially now, with all the savings on lodging, attractions, and fun. Visit FLAUSA.com to discover all the great hot Florida vacation deals. FLA USA.
This holiday, stay connected to the people who matter most. With the Shared Advantage plan from AT&T Wireless, you get unlimited local calling between five members. The dad can talk to mom, mom can talk to the kids, and the kids can talk to each other as often as they like. Start with two phone lines for $59.99 a month, and add up to three more for only $9.99 each. You can also get up to five free phones with nationwide long distance included and plenty of minutes to go around. All for life. Call 1-800-IMAGINE today for a gift that will have the whole family talking.
Ocean's 11 is the coolest. Pure fun. It's contagious. Two thumbs up.
Either in or you're out.
Ocean's 11, rated PG-13. Now play.
Make room for the steak-grilled stuffed burrito from Taco Bell. Grilled and stuffed with tender marinated carne asada steak, it's our biggest, best burrito ever. It's the heavy-duty, portable way to think outside the bun.
Saturn is working to keep our economy strong in jobs, in commerce, and in spirits. As part of that effort, we're providing interest-free financing on select 2002 coupes, sedans, and wagons. Come visit your Saturn retailer and keep America rolling.
I'll tell you what, I could talk about this.
The 2001 Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl has seen Pittsburgh continue its great offensive performance after the 1-5 start. Panthers have averaged 32 points per game. They are in position to go over, but you know that key number that the coaches love, turnovers, just over one per game in the last five, and nothing tonight. Green, who coordinates the NC State defense, saw his unit yield just three then. But the offense has only scored three for NC State tonight. The other touchdown came on a kickoff return by Greg Golden, who has it now. Well covered, Golden brought down 25. Not the best half Phillip Rivers has ever had. 14 to 55 yards to the sophomore from Athens, Alabama. Doc talked about the emotions at halftime from Chuck Amato. This is an opportunity now for Phillip Rivers. He's had a number of starts, even though he's a young quarterback. 23 starts, making his 24th career start tonight. Right. He needs to step up right now and make some plays. Four wide, one back. I think you'll see a bunch of that the rest of the way. Lost by Brian Peterson. Down by Mark Tonko, the senior safety, at the 31.
From all the years I've experienced in my coaching career, the guy that's making a halftime talk like Chuck Amato did is usually losing because they did a poor job of preparation the week during the game. And the reason that is I think this team, they came in here and thinking they were in a win pit because they had a lousy record, and now all of a sudden they're starting to use pep talk, and I promise you, unless I'm wrong, it ain't going to help
them. Rivers runs for the first down. Diving down at the 27-yard line. NC State did come down here 3 days earlier than Pittsburgh. They were here for 6 days total. The Panthers came in on Monday.
Really impressed tonight with this Pittsburgh defense. Paul Rhodes, the defensive coordinator, has a theory. 11 is playing as one, and tonight we're seeing that.
NC State not huddling after these first few plays. That is complete to Willie Wright, senior tight end who caught 40 this year. Picked up about five there. That first half short for NC State. Didn't run a bunch of plays other than that one field goal drive. Wasn't Douglas, to be honest. Really, those 32 yards were garbage yards at the end of the half with a couple of run plays when Pittsburgh was just protecting the deep ball. Second and six. That's pass interference. First down, NC State. Corey Cox got there too early on Troy Graham. Both Miami guys. Troy Graham went to Central High School in Miami, and Troy Northwestern.
thing that's changed so much about college football, coaches, you saw it last night. You have a quarterback and you have an offense, but you get into this no-huddle stuff, and you get four or five receivers out, quarterback throwing the ball downfield. You can come back in the game.
Yeah, no question.
I mean, this, you know, 17 points, 8:47 to go in the third quarter. That is...
Yeah, pass interference. It's a defense. The penalty is an automatic first down. It's a start of the foul. First down.
That's the spot of the foul because it's not beyond 15 yards.
5 or 10 years ago, you're talking about climbing a serious hill. But in today's game, with a quarterback like this, you can come back in a football game if you can play inspired on defense to get the ball back to Phillip Rivers. But they got to score on this drive.
That's Adam Sterling hit. First reception of the night. Well, freshman is by 12 this year. Brian Peterson is taken up.
The one thing that is impressive about Pittsburgh, they're flying around and hitting people a lot better than they did when we first saw them at the beginning of the year. Confidence, coaching, whatever you want to call it, they're a much better football team right now than they were at the beginning of the year.
That's why I was saying we talked about their turnaround. Forget the numbers. The numbers prove that they played better in the second half. I think just the speed of the defense,
everything.
They are flying around.
Peterson is pointing to his right knee. He's the junior who was top among the wide receivers in pass catches with 48 this year. Ray Robinson, the tailback, had 52. But then Peterson, who early on stepped into the role of Corin Robinson. Remember Robinson, the outstanding receiver, left early, goes to the Seattle Seahawks, where he's finally gotten up to speed from an NFL standpoint. He may have gone a little too early to the NFL. But Peterson was the one who stepped in, a high school quarterback who became a starter at wide receiver only after injuries. And the good news is he's jogging off the field after getting his legs tangled with Keegan Weir, the offensive lineman.
Yeah. Very dangerous.
And if there's anybody who knows about the injuries on the football field, it's Keegan Weir, the offensive lineman who didn't make it out of the opening game the last 2 years with broken leg injuries, but has made it the distance here in 2001. Even though Peterson's out, still four receivers, second and eight. They rush five. Rivers looks for the long ball. It was covered. He's taken off. He gets the first down and get out of bounds. That's the 35. Pick up a 12. Phillip's not really going to challenge anybody as a rushing quarterback. 4 yards gained. That's as long of the season there.
Well, he wanted Edwards on an out and up. Like you mentioned, a long ball. A little pump fake. Pittsburgh defense didn't buy into it. I tell you what, he reminds me so much of Bernie Kosar. You know, Bernie Kosar in college, where Bernie didn't have great speed, great agility. See, Edwards gets caught up there. Ponko stays with him. Downfield, there's nowhere to go. He just looks like that, the way he scrambles. Just enough mobility to pick up a couple first downs on his drive.
That's 5 to the 30. How does Ponko stay with Edwards? Devontae Edwards is a sleek, fat, down the field guy. Here's Ponko.
Short, 5'10", 200 pounder.
14 in blue. He's one of those guys who makes covering football fun. Third leading tackler on this Pittsburgh Panthers team. Quarterback of the secondary. Walked on in 97. Special teams MVP. And Keith Slayer keeping it all together in that secondary net. Robinson runs and is stopped by Gerald Hayes, first team all-conference linebacker. Here's Jerry to update us on Brian Peterson.
And pretty good news for NC State fans. Peterson, the junior, split in, came out, took a helmet to the outside of the right knee, came limping off. They thought he heard maybe a pop. They brought him to the sidelines. Mike Fagenbaum, team orthopedic surgeon, checked him over. He's up walking around. He should be back in momentarily, just a mile from
him. All right, Jerry, thank you. Third and three. You need to get to the 25 to keep this drive going. Rivers lost it as he went to throw it and now gets sacked. I'm saying incomplete pass in your mind, but I guess they ruled that the ball came out before the arm started going forward, so it's a recovered fumble.
Remember when Chuck Amato said it wasn't the X's and what's the O's, it's the execution of focus, it's things like that. I'll guarantee you he hasn't done that five times this year because he was focused better. I think the preparation for North Carolina State has been lacking before the game started. And I think they're trying to make up for it now with, you know, some good plays, et cetera, but they can't.
Flag down here, fourth and seven.
Well, dead ball foul. Just a piece of this roster. And this is off to
the it's interesting because I don't think they huddle. And substitution infraction is usually when you break the huddle with 12 and run somebody off the field. They were changing personnel in a no-huddle situation, but in any case, they're going to punt at 4th and 12. Only down 17 with 21 minutes left in the game. Oh, field goal. Correction. They're going to try the long field goal.
It comes
perhaps,
the pooch.
Perhaps the pooch punt from Austin Herbert. From here, it would be a 55-yard field goal, and there is the pooch kick. And Herbert does a nice job.
Nice.
Knocking it out at the 11. The old pooch punt.
The old pooch. That's coming back now.
There it is.
What game was with the kid was back there and it hit him and they lost the game?
We'll get that answer after this, please.
You're at a stoplight. You're making a turn. You're pulling into traffic. There are a lot of reasons every 2002 Saturn L Series comes standard with head curtain airbags. Those are just a few. The Saturn L Series.
Get 0% APR financing on select 2002 S or L Series models. For restrictions, see your retailer.
Pizza! In my family, if one wants pizza, the other wants Chinese. Even their stomachs don't agree. If one gets indigestion, the other one gets heartburn. If one gets nausea, the other one gets... So I get Pepto-Bismol. As it coats, it relieves heartburn, indigestion, upset stomachs, nausea, and diarrhea. It'd take a box full of other medicines to do what Pepto-Bismol does. Agree?
Agree.
Pepto-Bismol, first aid for heartburn, diarrhea, nausea, indigestion, and upset stomachs.
Major Applewhite is back as Texas fights to hold off Washington. Texas, Washington, the Culligan Holiday Bowl, Friday, December 28th on ESPN.
Growing up, all we wanted to do was play. But as the world opened up to us, it became easier to get sidetracked. And just one single bet, one simple step can blow not only our education, but a chance to compete in the sport that we love.
They watch from the stands while their money changes hands.
The only thing worth betting on is ourselves.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of the 2001 Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl is presented by Saturn. Now with two distinctly different car lines, the L Series and the S Series.
Mike Tirico, Lee Corso, Kirk Herbstreit, Jerry Punch, you're on TV, buddy. The 2001 Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl. In the break, Lee came up with the pooch punt answer.
Well, we all did. You said it was that Wisconsin.
Right.
Michigan pooched the ball down there. The freshman got it hit on his leg. Michigan recovered, kicked a winning field goal.
That's right, won the game.
I'm telling you.
You tell all the folks in Ann Arbor that their team will have shoulder pads and helmets for the game here on New Year's Day. The Michigan truck went past me as I was coming to the hotel this morning with their equipment driving down from Michigan. It's Michigan-Tennessee in the Citrus Bowl on this same field on New Year's Day.
Always a great bowl game. Citrus Bowl is always a great.
You came here a couple times, huh?
Oh, we used to live here in the early 90s at Ohio State.
They had your room set for you when
they
showed
up. Anybody. You show up, expect you to.
Well, yes. Pittsburgh in its first appearance in this bowl game since 1978. How about that for four drives?
You see, that's, I'm going back to a point. That comes from coaching, preparation, week of the game, not during the game.
I think it's hunger.
That's
desire.
That's focus, Kirk. That's focus.
Second and 10. State needs to make a big play here. English holds on tight, takes them to the 22-yard line.
Perfect. I think it's also, people need to understand where Pitt was early in this season after six games at 1-5. I mean, they had an opportunity. Imagine going to practice on a Monday and a Tuesday when you're 1-5 and you still have five games to go. That's tough. You can fold your tent very easily there mentally. They decided not to. and they went on to win five straight games.
Well, that's what Walt Harris said. Hey, if you want to be a part of this, show up on Monday ready to work. If not, turn them in.
Yeah.
Turn those jerseys in. We'll go on without you.
Walt said he got a lot tougher on him in practice, too. Maybe this is what it turns out when you get a little tougher on him.
Kirkley, 3 to the 25.
You know, I was talking to him yesterday. He said, we have so many good kids coming back for this year that maybe I thought, took some things for granted. Maybe I thought that I knew that they were going to be prepared in certain instances, mentally and physically, as we got ready in 2-a-days, and I should have been tougher on him. You know, he's still a young head coach as far as his experience is concerned. He learned a lot this year.
But Bryant likely to leave, but not too many other players departed. Berkeley's only a freshman. That whole offensive line is coming back. First down at the 33.
A little polite. You know, we talked about him running. That was a perfect example of a 6 foot, 240 pound, 45 pound sophomore fullback. Blocking the contain, man. Boom. I tell you what, the more I see a Luke White, the more I like him for the future. Now, you keep your eye, you'll see, why does this play good? Keep your eye right there on number 32, right there. That block here allows the guy to run by. This usually one key block on all good plays.
Berkeley, this time no key block comes for him.
Coach, you're talking about polite. You mentioned he's a sophomore. You have Kirkley, who's a freshman. You have Furman, who's the other running back, a freshman. All the offensive linemen back. If you're a wide receiver and you're being recruited by Pittsburgh, you're going to take a serious look at this system because of the way they throw the football. You're going to be able to recruit great athletes. They have some great players coming back at that position. The big thing for Walt next year will be the quarterback.
That's right.
And who will be able to pull the trigger and lead this team next year.
NC State injury here, and Santonio Burnett. So you have Burnett injured. He's the starting middle linebacker.
Linebacker.
We've already seen LeVar Fisher, the starting linebacker, out for the game with a broken arm. And Brian Jameson missed a few snaps as well with an injury. Fortunately, Burnett was running off under his own mound.
If you remember, they talked about the first time we had Chuck Amato, that Burnett got hurt in the Clemson game, and Clemson won the football game running the quarterback draw right where Burnett was. Mm-hmm. He thought he might be the most valuable football player he had, especially on the inside versus the run.
One of the hardest workers on the team. Got the most valuable lifter in 2001. Tells you about his preparation.
Mm-hmm. Second and 10 from the 33. Priestley throw is incomplete. For polite. You know, Lee, you mentioned Chuck Amato and Clemson, a game that NC State lost, 45-37 Clemson. It came down to Clemson or North Carolina State for this bowl berth. Chuck Amato came down here on the Friday before the selections happened on the weekend, brought some NC State shirts, memorabilia, trying to do a little recruiting of the people who would vote in the bowl game. State does have a better record overall, 7-4, compared to Clemson, 6-5. Both teams 500 in the league. They said, we'll bring people, and the sale works. Not that this team doesn't deserve to be here, but the enthusiasm to arrive was an influence. Briefly forced to get rid of that early because of the pressure of Terrence Martin, who had a sack earlier tonight.
I also think the Tangerine people wanted to have the teams that were hottest at the end of the year, a la basketball. And these two teams, as you mentioned in the open, I think the Sugar Bowl is the only game that has, these guys have 9 out of 10, right?
You got to cut, that's right. There are two other bowl games, both BCS games, that have the participants have won 9 of the last 10.
I guess the offense, not enough players on the line of scrimmage. That penalty is declined, fourth down.
And in the Sugar Bowl, you have it. Illinois and LSU coming in combined, they've won their last 12 games.
And I think that's very, very important when it comes to the bowl selection. And I don't think him coming down here with the t-shirt had anything to do with it.
Andy Alina punch, pressure on. They've been very good in getting it away. And a flag is down as well at the site of the kick. Tackle made by Corey Cox covering the 21. And a monster down where the kick happened.
hold on the Panthers. Jericho Cotchery, who made the catch on the punt, is shaken up as well. But Pittsburgh is staying relatively healthy here tonight. NC State's getting beat up in this game.
We have holding against the offense. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Replay fourth down.
And now Brian Peterson goes back to receive the punt. And he caught 8 punts this year.
Peterson comes limping onto the field. I mean, you're right. This team is banged up tonight. The team's favoring it.
They still 8 at the line of scrimmage and back 2 off. Perhaps to set up a little more of a return. This is special teams unit. Peterson, they're catching. Back at the 37-yard line. Phillip Rivers completed a whole mess of passes in his hot stretch at the end of the season for NC State. Tonight he's 11 of 17, only 67 yards. Will he get it going? We'll be right back.
The holidays have special meaning. It's a time to enjoy the pleasures of the season. A time for family and friends to share the love they have for one another. It's a time to thank those who mean so much to us. And it's a time for us to say thank you to our valued customers and friends. Happy holidays from all of us at AT&T Broadband.
Your Capital One card, but do watch Capital One Bowl Week on ESPN.
Tony Kornheiser, Michael Wilbon. We're fat, we're bald, we're old.
Hey, you're bald. I'm shaved.
You're shaved. A lot better. Pardon the interruption. 5:30 p.m. Eastern, weekdays on ESPN.
It's not pretty.
Phillip Rivers started this season by getting married. A longtime girlfriend from in Alabama, Tiffany. They met in Decatur, Alabama, back in eighth grade. They stayed together through high school, even though their high schools were rivals. And ended up getting married on May 19, 2001. Well, Chuck Amato was telling us yesterday, if everybody comes now, they want to be the guy to hang out with Phillip Rivers on their recruiting trip. But Chuck's got to make sure that Phillip's wife, Tiffany, is paying. From the 37. This guy's receiver's going here. Down the field somewhere. He's running for space to throw. It's caught. It hits the grab made for the first down by Owen Hanum, the backup quarterback. 22-yard pickup. Here's Garrett.
Well, we're not good again on the NC State sideline. Take a look at the very uncomfortable Jericho Cotchery, the 6'1", 194-pound sophomore. Head of the locker room and examined his right ankle, and he's very point tender over the distal part of the fibula, the small bone and lower leg. They're going to take him in for x-rays. Hopefully it's a sprain, but not going to take any chance to take him in, take a picture. We'll let you know when we get some word from the locker room.
Michael? All right, Jerry. That's a tough blow. He's become the go-to guy for this team. Willie Wright dropped it. Just behind him. Pass is incomplete. Cotchery is heading to the locker room. Was a big rival of Phillip Rivers in their high school days in Alabama, in Birmingham. As a matter of fact, Cotchery and Rivers went head-to-head in a basketball game. Cotchery guarded Rivers and completely shut him down in that game. Phillip said, I had 4 points and fouled out. Now, on the football field, Rivers' team got the better of Cotchery. Those two have become very good friends and a great pass-catch combination here of late. Complete to Devontae Edwards across the 30 into the 29-yard line, first down.
It's unfortunate, obviously, about Sautry's injury. Combined, he and Peterson, the top two wide receivers in this offense. Now you have to rely on some freshmen and sophomores who have ability, but still are going to be players down the road. Tonight, they're going to have to grow up and help this offense out.
This whole drive, five receivers, no back. First and 10. Pass is caught by Willie Wright to the 25-yard line.
Good call, by the way, on Kozar.
Even the delivery, kind of a sidearm.
That's a good call.
Want to say one thing. This five wide receiver look is working for a reason. They're spreading the Pittsburgh defense out now. There's eight defensive backs and linebackers spread all over the field. And Pittsburgh's been rushing three. Now they're going to change things up, but they're not getting the same amount of pressure on Phillip Rivers. He's finding the receivers that he needs to get the ball to.
Complete to Devontae Edwards. Slips and fell at the 10.
If you'll notice also, because the offensive set is spread out, he can see the defense's blitzes better. And he's hitting what they call a hot man. That time, the outside corner area man came, and he hit a receiver right behind him. This is a nice change of pace by Sacramento for this set.
Bunch of freshmen, the backup quarterback. The cast of characters of receiver here right now. Again, the freshman Edwards. He has the first down at six. There's no tempo up, but they won't get to a play here before we get to the fourth quarter. NC State showing signs, but they've got to do it on this drive. Down 17, and up we go to the fourth quarter from Orlando.
Pardon the interruption. 5:30 weekdays on ESPN. Again at 7 on ESPN2.
Saturn is working to keep our economy strong. In jobs, in commerce, and in spirit. As part of that effort, we're providing interest-free financing on select 2002 coupes, sedans, and wagons. Come visit your Saturn retailer and keep America rolling.
When it's time to get the girl in your life something special.
We just had a baby.
Say hi, Nina.
The last month of my pregnancy, I was a blimp, and it was not feeling very attractive.
Walmart jewelry probably has just what you're looking for.
One day he comes in and hands me this box, and he says it's a birthstone ring.
At an everyday low price.
I said, honey, it's beautiful, but it's not my birthstone. He said, I know. It's Nina.
Walmart jewelry. Special gifts for special girls.
The bow. Resistance becomes strength, becomes power. The power to change and reshape your entire body. This is Bowflex, an entire gym in one easy-to-use machine. So powerful, it delivers over 60 health club quality exercises with up to 410 pounds of resistance in any room in your home. Strength training with Bowflex is so effective that we guarantee you'll get the results you want in 6 weeks or less. One simple workout. 20 minutes a day, 3 days a week. Bowflex is real. The results are real. And you can own one with no money down and payments as low as $33 per month. Call right now for a free video and brochure. Bowflex, the power is yours.
Well, Epcot, in the middle there, Disney World Resort, Magic Kingdom, and great. The character breakfast was awesome this week.
Oh,
my little guy was dialed into the character breakfast.
That's good.
Oh, we had fun. Breakfast with Pooh Bear this morning, and the game with you tonight. How good is that?
Life is good.
Good game, better than that. We go to the fourth quarter.
I think the production meeting was probably the highlight of the year. Thanks to Steve Turnberger, I think it was a highlight.
The Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl. Phillip Rivers has had an outstanding drive. They need to get a touchdown. It's first and goal. For the second straight game, they enter the fourth quarter without an offensive score. But get one here on the touchdown to Devontae Edwards.
For a number of plays here. Punt goes way off the line in man coverage. And I'm sure Phillip Rivers saw that right when he got the snap. He decided to take advantage of that. And Edwards with a quick out right at the goal line made a nice catch for the touchdown.
Adam Piker on to add the extra point.
Well, could be returned for two if Pittsburgh can get there.
The angle is cut off and he'll be taken down at the 35-yard line. It was picked up by Ramon Walker. A tough snap for Jeremy Mebane to handle, and Joe Conlon got in there and blocked it. He didn't back in his body.
I think the snap also was very hard. Watch it. It went right past him almost.
A little high,
but he got it down.
Yeah.
But it messed up the timing.
Yeah.
And by messing up the timing, he didn't go through the follow-through.
And now it's an 11-point game, so they'll need a touchdown, two-point conversion, and field goal.
You know what this reminds me of with all these substitutes in there for North Carolina State? The other night I'm watching Coach K, like Duke basketball game against Kentucky.
Mm-hmm.
And Kentucky comes out and runs them off the court. He calls timeout, takes all his superstars, and sits them down. And says, yo, they're not playing Duke basketball. Back and back, but he puts them back in the ball game, and the young guys come back and win the ball game. If North Carolina State is going to win this football game, they're going to have to win it with the enthusiastic second and third guys who have not been in there as much this year.
Like Devontae Edwards, who caught four passes on that drive, a good drive for Phillip Rivers. Piker to kick off. Corey Cox, Dante Spencer away. Seven with a seam, and the kicker pushes him towards the sideline and out of bounds at the 49. A return of 42 for Corey Cox, junior from Miami.
Pittsburgh gets the momentum back after North Carolina State scores, and Phillip Rivers throws this right to a spot. And Edwards, you can tell that's one of these things that you work on over and over and over. The relationship between the quarterback and the receiver. I tell you, Phillip Rivers is unorthodox. He's not gonna impress you with style points, but he knows where to put the football, and that time he put it right where it had to be for his receiver to make the catch.
Edwards, the freshman, caught one touchdown this year in the first 11 games. Big drive for the NC State defense and the Pittsburgh offense. Kirkley. Flag down as he gets to the State 44.
Boy, I tell you what, Thunder Dan Burnett's trying to do everything he can out there to help this defense out. And here, he gets tangled up in the Pittsburgh offensive line. It was a very obvious hole. Pittsburgh's offensive line, nice job of drive blocking, but right there, Matt Morgan just locks on to Burnett, doesn't allow him to get to Kirkley. Good call by the official.
So we're going to have first and 15 because holding is marked off from the spot of the infraction.
say, for a team that's trying to play with urgency, they're getting pushed off the line of scrimmage. Reese with a throw on first down. Getting out of bounds. Here comes Thunder Dan after you, the second leading tackler on this team. It's been a terrific week of sports on ESPN. It continues with the Division I AA National Championship game. Ron Franklin, Mike Godfrey, Adrian Carson will join you from Chattanooga as the Paladins of Furman, 12-2, take on the Grizzlies of Montana, 14-1, 5:30 Eastern special time on ESPN. Billy Napier did a good job in the national semifinal game. How about Johan Humphrey? Given Adrian Peterson a run for it this year in terms of those 100-yard games. It is second and a dozen. First play is back. Terrence Chapman. Second one of the night for him. Third for the Wolfpack as a team.
This play, number 52 from 6, Dan LeCarte, got good position to block, but then watch him. You'll see the left guard right there. He gets his feet tangled up. He doesn't keep in front of the guy. The reason why he didn't do a good job was because he didn't keep his feet and he didn't see him.
You understand, your North Carolina State's been burnt tonight in one-on-one coverage. This time, great coverage downfield to allow Chapman to get the pressure to get to Priestley.
Antonio Bryant. I wanted to say his name because we have him in the third quarter and fourth. No catches. Third and long. Looking for Bryant in double coverage. And it's incomplete. Freshman, true freshman, Andre Maddox was there in coverage.
Went 30-19, you know they're going to try to dial up number 80. This time they went back and had him covered. They had a coverage underneath with Williams, and the freshman Maddox comes back and gets a hand on the ball because he had Williams beat again to his post. Good thing they had Maddox back there to help out, and that could have been another touchdown.
Devontae Edwards is back to receive the punt. After Peterson and Cochrane have been banged up. They're showing Andy Lee some different pressure here. And a flag down. Flag down. And NC State was moving on the line. It may have been caught in the neutral zone.
Could have been one of those where North Carolina State jumped and it made Pitt
move. Dead ball foul. False start against the offense. Losing the offense of the NFL Tigers here. Tangerine Tuesday. Still 14.
I love when coaches do that to the assistant. Hey, get back, the head coach says, so I can tell the official how bad the call was. Get back and let me tell him how horrible it was.
Watching the Tennessee-Florida game, Philip Plumer has an assistant coach assigned to him.
That's right.
Great coach. To keep him from going too far out or too long.
In the NFL, they call him the get-back coach.
Yep.
Fourth and 24. Is hunt pressure coming.
Hey, protected very well.
26, freshman Edwards, no chance. Corey Cox has been fabulous tonight on special teams. Devontae Edwards has never caught a punt in his college career. And he was not thinking anything about returning. He was thinking about holding on and don't give it up. Boy, Phillip Rivers had a good last drive or what?
Terrific. Now, the key point about trying to catch people is the following stat I'm going to give you. When North Carolina State scored, it only took North Carolina State 1 minute 39 seconds to get the ball back. You have rallies with defense.
That chance here. Able to throw the ball as Edwards, but he takes it. And what technically they're on. That side looks for the late hit flag, and they get it. Devontae Edwards hit after he was over on the white at the sideline by Ramon Walker. Going to move him down the field, 15. What is it about bowl games? Have these dramatic turn in momentum.
After the play was over, we have a dead ball, personal foul, against the defense, a late hit out of bounds, 15-yard penalty from the
both teams last year. Yeah. NC State fell behind 24-0 in the Micron PC Bowl against Minnesota, came back and won. Pittsburgh fell behind 27-7 in the Inside.com Bowl against Iowa State. They lost the game, but they really made it a competitive second half. And we saw last night the 38-8 deficit for Marshall erased against East Carolina. Rivers, fire, incomplete. Jeremy Mabane, and here is Jerry.
Guys, talk about the toll this game has taken on NC State starters. The wounded Wolfpack, LeVar Fisher, the leading tackler in the history of the NC State University, broken arm. He is out. Brian Peterson, leg contusion is tightened up. He may not be back in the ballgame. Brian Jameson, thigh bruise. And x-ray reports on Jericho Cotchery a moment ago. X-rays are negative. Pretty significant ankle sprain. He's done for the night.
Thanks, Jerry. Complete Edwards. He's gotten a lot of mileage out of that. So, Kirk, they're doing this five receiver thing without Cotchery for the rest of the game,
without Peterson. That's what I was going to say. Last year in the bowl game against Minnesota, the big comeback, they had Corn Robinson. Corn Robinson had a huge second half. Tonight, their two top receivers are now down. Now they're relying on a lot of youth, even a backup quarterback within this five wide receiver set. So if they're able to pull this comeback with this group, boy, that says a lot about Phillip Rivers' ability and the coach's ability to make the adjustment.
Third and a yard. Willie Wright, tight end. One up and got it. That's one reason you can play five wide with the injuries, because of the wide receiver skills of the 6'4", 240 tight end.
One thing I'm surprised to see is Pittsburgh, was against this five wide receiver look, they're playing off the ball. And because of that, Phillip Rivers is saying, hey, guys, I'm going to take that all day. Nickel and dime them, throwing underneath to these receivers and picking up 5-6 yards at a time. He's trying to bait him to come up, and then he'll go over him.
This is four wide, one back. Ray Robinson. Throw toss out to Devontae Edwards. Hit by Walker. At the 40.
That was a perfect example of a quarterback automatic from a shot. The reason why he's in the shotgun at the beginning is to throw the ball, but he must get in the quarterback position to throw this pass, because the timing is better from a quarterback position there than it is back in the shotgun. And that's why he moved up to call that automatic.
Second and seven, Robinson. Ray Robinson, break three. To the 10, first and goal for the Wolfpack. Was coming at some point, didn't you?
It's showing a lot of the empty set with Phillip Rivers back there by himself. You saw this last play where you saw Ray Robinson in, where they dumped the ball out real quick to Edwards, and this time with Robinson back in the shotgun. They basically have been setting them up for this call and waited for the exactly the perfect time to go to it to pick up big yardage.
Sean Burton's in at tight end, number three. Hannum is the quarterback. Rivers motions out to the bottom of the screen. We got people everywhere. Hannum. It's a lot for a gain of a yard. Owen Hannum tackled by Gerald Dave. Hannum, a senior quarterback, transferred from a junior college to Utah, Snow Junior College. Played special teams and receiver, as we've mentioned. He's a rodeo guy as well. And I mentioned, you know, Tony Pickett, we're going to see the Washington quarterback. I figured, yeah, no, they rodeo together. No. Hannum has gone to the rodeo and done rodeo with Pickett's dad, right? Rivers back at the quarterback to right. That is complete to the 2-yard line. Third and goal coming up.
Come the big boys. Come the big boys. 4-5, big, huge linemen, tight ends, running backs. They're going to go to a different formation here. This is Phillip Rivers. This is what people love about Phillip Rivers, is how quick he gets rid of the football. And when he gets inside the red zone, he's going to look up really right as often as possible when they're going to throw the football.
Maybe the pass at the extra tight end here. They run Robinson. He stops.
Well, what do you do here? It's an 11-point game. You need a field goal at some point.
I kick the field goal.
Okay.
And the reason I kick the field goal, I want to keep the momentum on my side. I know if you score, it's wonderful, but if I got at least three, I got 19, it looks better. That's my opinion. Psychologically, I would go to make scoring something.
It's a one-possession game. If you score, you'd only be down eight. They call timeout to think about it. Fourth down decision coming up. Will be an Adam Piker kick for fourth and goal for two. Well, Philip Rivers on the sideline tells you they're not going for it. They will try the field goal. Adam Piker, who had his last extra point blocked. This is a 19-yard field goal attempt. Timing was good, so was the kick.
Let me give you the main reason I think Chuck Amato made an executive decision, because assistants always want to go for touchdowns. It's the head coach's team. He's going, let me tell you why. It only took them 1 minute and 39 seconds on defense to get the ball the last time. I think if his defense can stuff him down, then he goes for it and goes for all the games. Right now, go get it.
The end's exclusive presentation. 2001 Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl is presented by Visit Florida. For hot Florida vacation deals, go to flausa.com. And in part by Chrysler, we're reinventing the passion for driving.
Downtown Orlando, host of two bowl games. The Florida Citrus Bowl and the Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl. This one is staying close down the stretch. The lead is 8 at the 9:39 mark, fourth quarter. North Carolina State has seized momentum. Story Cox from the 5. Nice return last time. This time, nowhere to go as Craig Moody made the play, 24. Reserve DB.
Phil Rivers has been 12 for 14 for 88 yards in the last part of the ball game right here. One touchdown. The key part of his play, as Kirk's talked about it all night, is that quick release. I don't think I've seen anybody in college football this year throw the ball like, poof, like that. He throws it as good as anybody when it comes to the quick release.
See what Pittsburgh can do offensively here. Kind of lost their rhythm and momentum as an offense.
Uh-oh.
Mistake there with one of the freshman tailbacks. Priestley able to run it to the 31. Picked up 9. I'm pretty sure it was a mistake.
Yeah, it was.
It looked good, though.
Yeah, it did. Priestley's got some wheels.
Yeah, he's been able to get out of some trouble tonight.
We're talking about a lot about Antonio Bryant, his ability, and a lot of us assuming he'll take a jump to the NFL. I think David Priestley, just coming out of this offense, will have a chance somewhere in the NFL. Probably a late round guy, but he'll definitely get a look. You can see the breakdown. And there's the experience, turning it upfield and showing some pretty good speed to make it set a second 12. And I'm looking at second 1.
Mm-hmm.
Just rewinding the play clock here. Ran out of bounds, so no time moving. Priestley tonight, 18 of 31, 271 yards, and a couple of touchdowns. Lusaka Polite, the fullback, takes it across the 35 for a first down. Pittsburgh, one of the 5 Big East teams in postseason. Boston College will play Georgia in the Music City Bowl. Syracuse, Kansas State in the Insight.com. Virginia Tech, Florida State in the Gator Bowl. And, of course, Miami, Nebraska. The Rose Bowl presented by AT&T. The capper to the bowl championship series, seen on ABC. The 35, Kirkwood. The 4 to the 39, Pat Thomas. In on that first down tackle. Well, speaking of bowls, we've got a lot of guys smiling. It happens. And so are we. We have 12 games in 6 days. Bowl week begins on Thursday, December 27th. We get the pleasure going back to the other great city on our tour.
Beautiful downtown San Diego.
You got it. Bye-bye.
And a great matchup.
Pelican Holiday Bowl, Texas and Washington. Great bowl schedule again here on ESPN. It's already started, too. Second and 10, toss to Kirkley. Good play, Terrence Martin again. He's had a good pressure, a sack, and a forced incompletion early. A nice run stop there.
Great movement for a big guy on the inside, weighing over 290 pounds. He moves like a defensive end. Again, he's only a sophomore. It's a big, big down for North Carolina State's defense trying to get the ball back to Phillip Rivers.
They must try a way. If they've got six guys on him, still throw the ball to number 80, Antonio Bryant.
He's down here. A couple of people looking after him. Casey waiting on his side as well. The motion is swayed. He wasn't ready for it. Time to throw for Slade is incomplete. Antonio Bryant wanted it. I think it was thrown to Antonio Bryant.
Right.
It's a first down. If Slade doesn't go up, the ball is going right to Antonio Bryant. That's why he's a little frustrated.
And he leads the punt. Yard kick, Devontae Edwards. His first collegiate punt return. He pulled down at the 20-yard line. He was able to return it 11 yards. Last year, it was a big hole for Chuck Amato's team. In the Micron PC Bowl, down 24-0, but Kirk mentioned they had number 3, Corn Robinson, top 10 pick, even though he came out after just a couple of years. And then the NC State special teams got it going with a block. Ray Robinson, a touchdown to cap the comeback and beat Minnesota 38-30. The hole was not as severe here this year, but it felt that way, 27-10 to start the fourth quarter.
And a couple of quarterback draw the option of some sort.
With Olin Hannum. To the 25, it's like watching Matt Moss from LSU. The backup quarterback comes in, snaps and runs.
What makes it good is because Hannum's been playing a lot of wide receiver in this half, you can't tell that he's coming into the game to have this play called. So from a personnel standpoint, Pittsburgh doesn't really know when he's going to be lining up at quarterback or when he's going to be lining up at wide receiver.
Five receivers again. To reiterate, Cotchery out, Peterson out. Those are the two top receivers. Point for Nick Locke. Holiday season underway here in Orlando, and you have the busiest week of the year.
Exactly.
Next week, right, Lou?
At the airport. Next week.
How about tomorrow morning?
Be there early, Test your patience.
Test your patience. 34-19 the lead. Lewis Moore forced the fumble that led to the touchdown from Tyree Young. This is the guy who's going to be redshirted. He's an undersized linebacker, or undersized nose guard who was playing linebacker. Middle of the year, they said, well, we need to get this guy on the field, and we need some presence up there up front. Took the red shirt off. He played his first career game in South Bend at Notre Dame. Had a big fumble recovery against Virginia Tech, and a huge one here tonight. Fred Golden has a touchdown on kickoff return earlier tonight. This one comes out to the 35.
Earlier in the second half, North Carolina State's gone to a lot of five wide receiver set. Well, you can see right here that Pittsburgh's been playing the corners off. This time, look at all the corners, how they're up tight into the line of scrimmage. And I think that confusion allowed Lewis Moore to come right here and make the big sack, because as the quarterback Phillip Rivers gets back, you can see hesitate, boom. By the time he's about to pull the trigger, Moore's already there to make the big play to give Pittsburgh a decisive lead.
And part of that situation comes when you have a five receiver set, you don't have it back to pick up anybody. So the blind side, a right-handed quarterback's blind side is usually to his left. But in this situation, it happened to be to his right. And I think that was a good defensive call there by the Pittsburgh set.
Guys, this is inexcusable. North Carolina State just had to take a timeout as they were coming out for the first down play after a TV timeout and a kickoff. And there's a lot of yelling back and forth there between coaches and players. I don't know who's at fault, but that is completely inexcusable when you're down 15 and need every timeout you have. And there's absolutely no explaining that. That's bad. Frank, am I wrong?
No, absolutely. And I think that...
It's TV time. I had 2 minutes to figure out what you were doing.
You know what that is? You're thinking you're coming back. You're thinking you're coming back. We put ourselves in a position. We're one series away, going for two, tying this thing up, and all of a sudden that happens. And mentally, somebody had a lapse. And when you have that happen, you know, as a coach, that's very frustrating. After a time, I mean, especially after a kickoff, where the clock isn't moving.
Hanging out here, looking at Christmas at Disney World. 34-19. Rivers back on the field. Last time he returned a fumble for a touchdown in a bowl game. Oh, I'll tell you that was good. But Rivers threw this one complete to somebody on the sideline. Doesn't count. The last time Pitt returned a fumble for a touchdown in a bowl game was the 1928 Rose Bowl.
Wow. Good stuff.
Good stuff. Dad's been to a bunch of bowls. But they've been to enough that you figure that, you know, they'd have one in between. An 8-12 is Pittsburgh's all-time bowl record. Second and 10. Willie Wright, the tight end. First down, out of bounds. Gerald Hayes pushed
him. North Carolina State, they still have time, and with Phillip Rivers throwing the ball, they still have a chance to come back. But I got to tell you something. I don't know if people can really understand what could be accomplished tonight for Pittsburgh. You look at 1-5. People talk about the BCS. People talk about the second-tier bowls not meaning anything. Tell that to the Pittsburgh football players and coaching staff that were 1-5 at one point in this season, went on to win 5 in a row, and have a chance if they win this game to go 7-5. Tell them that these second-tier bowl games don't mean anything.
Rivers. Nice touch. Robinson, the leading receiver on this team this year, made the catch at the Panther 37-yard line. Fourth catch of the evening.
And when they, you know, if they get a chance to put six up on the board here, go back to that timeout, Mike, that you were pretty frustrated about.
I'm frustrated. You're concerned.
I don't understand.
I don't care who wins.
Right.
No, seven overtime game.
Right. I hear you. But at least they're getting out of bounds here.
Yep. Deflected and incomplete.
Pass was tipped.
Pittsburgh's doing a nice job now of settling in a lot of defensive players a la Florida State style, especially since, you know, those defensive linemen get tired when they have to rush the passer. There's more energy put on rushing the passer than any other phase of an offensive or defensive football game.
Claude Harriott now comes in. 90 is sophomore. Good looking player, Claude Harriott. Tori Koskio's blitz, here he comes. Where he was is where Devontae Edwards made the catch. And he grabs his knee. Comes up a little bit deeper.
Edwards has been really busy in the second half. He came into the game with only 11 receptions on the year. And six tonight.
All here in the half. Missed over the 29. Would show. Looks broad. Pass caught. Willie Wright, first down, 25.
That's complete for Willie Wright.
A reminder that as soon as we're done, it's John Anderson and Linda Cohen for Sports Center. For a coaching meltdown, a faceless at Fenway, and favorite hoop voices. And all of us in this profession, our thoughts to Chick Hearn, missing his first game in 36 years.
Wow.
UCF in Central Florida. This is the home field for the Golden Knights. Now part of the Mid-American Conference. Sacked by Ryan Smith. Had three this year, the junior from Philadelphia.
I think that was caused as much by the deep off these receivers not playing together because there was a slight adjustment. In other words, he was supposed to do something based on the defense, and none of them did anything right. And Rivers just took a bad play.
Sherman back out. Now they're bringing more heat. Pass caught by Edwards, but right behind where the blitz was. Ramon Walker.
They talk a lot about fight adjustments. I think Paul Rose, the defensive coordinator, has found a weakness in this offense. By blitzing certain players, he knows that he can get Rivers to get rid of it quickly. They're willing to give that little underneath stuff. Give that up when you have a 15-point lead. Relying the corners of the safeties come up and make the tackle. Now it's third and 10.
Needing to get to the 15. Fourth and 7. Devontae Edwards catch 8.
That's a perfect way to explain why do you think a guy throws the ball for 7 yards when he needs 15? Well, if there's four guys coming after you and you only got three blockers, you don't have time to throw the 15. So you got to hope that you throw the ball 7. He breaks the tackle and the guy
either throw the ball or get a bloody lift.
Throw it.
And then hopefully break the tackle. Get rid of it.
And Pittsburgh defense will use a timeout here, knowing that a fourth down stop will leave them in great stead. With 3:32 to go, fourth quarter. Tangerine ball has been around for 2 decades and has come back in good form tonight. Some of the pictures from Walt Disney World in Orlando, thanks to the Monster.com blimp covering tonight's Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl. That blimp's 165 feet long, 55 feet tall, and you have to coordinate a lot of things to get the blimp and the pictures. And Catherine O'Reilly is the person who's done that for Monster.com for 7 years.
Wow.
She is leaving to become a mom, the most important job in the world.
For her.
Due in April of 2002, so
busy.
Catherine, all the best.
Busiest job in the world.
He knows it's a girl.
Oh.
Fourth and 7. NC State knows it needs to be the 15 or else. They rush four. Rivers throws. Incomplete. Pittsburgh takes over on down. Rivers, whose numbers have improved here in the second half, not able to complete it there. And maybe one of the most encouraging signs for Pittsburgh fans this year is even though Antonio Bryant has not caught a ball and really hasn't had one thrown near him in the second half, he was the first offensive player applauding the defense.
Yeah,
after their hold up.
And we should definitely talk about that because I remember in the Miami game, we're pretty critical of him in certain times when he's come off the field. Tonight he's been very positive. First one to applaud the defense all night tonight, see? And he hasn't had a chance to make the plays in the second half. So I think that shows how much he's grown up and matured here.
We've got the polite with that carry. So here was the Rivers toss and Corey Cox around it.
A good defense by Gerald Hayes. And watch Bryant Washington. He wanted to pick, yep. So the first guy out there to pat their guys on the back and say, way to go. And that's, as you mentioned, different. Walt Harris would have every reason to say, now this guy's been a pain in the butt. And at every turn, Walt Harris will tell you, he's got it. Tony Bryant's really a good kid. The run by Kirkley goes nowhere. It's 2:40 left. NC State's going to use its final timeout here to stop the clock. Once somebody sees it, and 7 seconds later they do, as it gets to 2:33. Talk about Antonio Bryant, and somebody who thinks he's pretty darn good is with Doc.
And that would be his proud mother, Irene Bryant, all the way from Miami, Florida. And Miss Irene, I got to tell you, I watched you come down the stands and enjoy this football game. You've got to be so proud of your young man and how far he has come under Coach Harris.
Yes, I am very proud of Antonio. He's matured a lot in this last year, and he has grown to respect Walt and J.B. Borghetti, and they have done a tremendous job with Antonio. I'm more than grateful.
Now, Walt had to almost discipline him like a father, had to sit on him a couple times to get him to grow up a little bit, but it's really paid off in at least the last half of the season.
Exactly. You've done a great job with Antonio, and Antonio respects him a great deal. He's never turned his back on Antonio through all the things that Antonio has been through this year. And, I mean, he respects him, you know.
You know, there's a lot of people who are pulling at Antonio because of his ability, what they see tonight, to make him make a decision at the end of this year to do something. Do you have a thought as a mom as to what you'd like to see him do, whether to stay in school or go on and play in the league?
Antonio academically is smart, and I really prefer him to get an education more than football because education will take him further than, you know, sports right now.
I agree. Spoken like a proud mother. Congratulations on a great son and a great year for Pittsburgh football.
Thank you.
Irene Bryant, proud of her son here tonight. What an effort he put in here in their final game of this 2001 season.
Thank you, Jerry. You talked about Irene, who was very young when Antonio was born, timeout taken by Pittsburgh. Mom took odd jobs to make sure that everything was okay for her son. Anybody who's been raised by a single mom knows how important those people are in their lives. And this lady would put back her nail polish remover when she was shopping at the store just so she could give Antonio a little something extra that he wanted. So he's had that background, being raised by a single mom, as successfully as she could in a tough area of Miami. And on the football field, we've seen tonight why he is so respected for his ability.
She's done a great job with him, and I know it's going to make his decision very tough. He wants to make his mom proud, and he also wants to be able to have a chance to take care of her. Touchdowns early in this game for him. He got a lot of one-on-one opportunities. The post corner, then he gets deep behind Brian Williams, and he disguises that he's going to the corner on the fade and comes back and quickly put the ball right on the money. Those two were really in sync in the first half, and Antonio Bryant has stayed positive. And people that aren't familiar with him would say, why are they making such a big deal that he's staying positive? If you followed his career, the fact that he hasn't had a ball thrown to him in the second half, and he's still moving around, still has bounce in his step, tells you a lot about how he has matured.
Third and eight coming up here. NC State hopes to stop Pittsburgh, make something happen in special teams. Priestley will hand it off on the delay. Polite banged around and brought down. Andre Maddox leading the charge. Now with no timeout remaining, the clock will tick inside of 2 minutes before the punt. There's the trophy. Go to the winner of the Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl, and it's the Charles Rowe Trophy. A for Chuck Rowe. You see the trophy goes to the winner. Chuck Rowe is the executive director of Florida Pittsburgh Sports, retiring after this year. The man is so responsible for the growth. Pittsburgh Bowl, now this game. Pittsburgh has handled the pressure. Looks fine tonight. 47-yard kick. Devontae Edwards to the 28. To the 35. The big hit from Tyrone Gilliard, the defensive back.
Chuck Rowe is retiring, as we talked about it, and they've got Tom Mickle now as the new executive director of the Pittsburgh Bowl. Tom was an outstanding assistant commissioner for John Swall for the ACC. In fact, they say he might be the father of the BCS. I know they talk about the guys in the SEC, but I think that he might be the guy to come up with the formula. So they are in good hands here with Tom Nichols as the new executive director.
Florida Citrus Sports, 900-plus members who are involved in helping to get this game, Citrus Bowl that comes up next week, the Gridiron Classic in January, all run at a very high level. 94 seconds for NC State to do it twice. Almost intercepted by Amir Purifoy. We've talked about the seniors and the players who might come back, who are coming back. Amir Purifoy, number 9, and Ryan Gonzalez, number 55, are two senior linebackers who in the thinner days of this Pittsburgh program were starters. As recruiting has improved, more talented athletes, physically gifted athletes have come in. So these guys have become reserves, but they haven't hung their head and said, hey, forget it, your program, I'll just hang in here for the free ride.
Yeah.
They're both on the field here at the end of the game. Incomplete. Gonzalez right in the middle of that play. Purifoy was putting on some pressure.
And they're Tangerine Bowl champions.
Right.
2023.
One of the reasons they're able to stay positive is they rotate in quite a bit. You know, they still get a chance to play. Uh-oh. And you know what? He deserves this after the season they've had.
Yeah, you got to be careful. A minute 23 left. Game's not over. You know, they can hit a big play and score. So,
yeah. So you know what? He's good. They're going to get him very much.
Keeping everybody around for sports generally. Coming up with John Anderson and Linda Cohn as soon as we're done.
Making a move now.
There they come.
We got Walt blocked, which is a great thing here. You can't even see the coming. Here it comes. Oh.
Coach off the field for this play. Intercepted! Corey Cook! He's at the 10, he's at the 5, and he's out of bounds at the 2. Phillip Rivers knocked him out, and now it's over.
He's heading out.
I want to say something about Phillip Rivers as being a former coach.
Yep.
You're losing. You're the All-American, you're married, life is going good, you throw an interception like that on national television, the thing is over, but watch the way he comes down the line of scrimmage, and he comes right there in good football now. Watch it. He throws the intercept, but this is my keeper on this trip. He's in good football position, and he doesn't give up. Boom! Damn it, he said, that guy's not going to score on my play. That tells me 1,000 things about his character right there. That kid can play for me any day of the week.
Oh, he's going to have a great career. Oh. His numbers tonight, his completion percentage was up, but you're right. Anytime a quarterback throws an interception late in the play, you're kind of protecting your turf.
You made the mistake, you can't let him get in there.
I'm sure that never happened to you, but if it happens to some other quarterbacks, then they know that they're not going to score on your watch.
That's right.
Tangerine thrown down there. Pittsburgh took a delay of game. This is going to be the first bowl win for Pitt since the 1989 victory over A&M, Texas A&M, in the John Hancock Bowl. Bowl down in El Paso that's had 9 different names. The Big East will start the bowl season with a victory. Pitt was the only Big East team to lose a bowl game last year. The conference went 4-1.
I said it earlier and I'll say it again. Even though this bowl game isn't a BCS bowl game, this does a lot for this program after the start they've had. You can see how much this meant to Walt Harris. 1-5, finishes 7-5, wins 6 in a row. Now they go into winter conditioning with some momentum. They finish recruiting with some momentum. They get into spring ball. It'll carry over to 2002. This was huge and a testament to him as a head coach.
Good stuff. Stuff down there on the sideline. I echo your point. As full voice as possible, the people who are the ones who say, oh, you can't have these other bowl games, they're the people who don't get in touch with college athletics. Yeah. They sit in their big cities, open their mouth on Sunday on TV, and aren't a part of college sports.
And then go disappear into the woodwork. That's the
impossible way.
You can't find these guys.
You got it.
They make a comment on Sunday, and the sports reporters or something, and they say, yeah, and they disappear. You never see the guy again.
If this is Antonio Bryant's final moment in the Pittsburgh uniform, it is one of celebration. Chuck Amato and Walt Harris get together to congratulate each other's teams. And Pittsburgh
won the 2001 Visit Florida Tangerine Bowl. We continue our coverage on ESPN News, so don't go away for that. SportsCenter's next on ESPN. Malik Corso, Kirk Herbstreit, Dr. Jerry Punt, and our producer Tim Corrigan, director Mike Schwab. Mike Tirico saying thanks for watching this presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com. Your home for college football on the internet. SportsCenter's next. Have a very Merry Christmas, everyone. Pittsburgh wins the Tangerine Bowl.
This is SportsCenter.
He's seen it all, from Jerry to Magic to Shaq. Tonight, you will see something no one's seen since 1965.
You can't keep chicks down for very long. He's the best at what he does.
We open the treasure chest with some great NBA announcers, and we'll see who's your favorite.
Uno, dos, tres, ole!
Ole!
I'm sick and tired of all this bullshit.
There's a new boss in Beantown, but is there a new center fielder? And can the Red Sox make a run at the revamped Yankees?
We couldn't do diddly. Cool.
There's a revolving door at the top of the AFC Central. How the Steelers became champ du jour. The rivalry between John Chaney and John Calipari is renewed, and heads are a one-of-a-kind look at coaching meltdown. Sports Center. We never judge a book by its cover.
This is your failure, fat kid.
You're still there. I am Linda Cohn, and that is John Anderson.
And we get along just well.
Yes.
Now. As you saw, 10 temper tantrums for the ages, and Diamondback's number one choice for a number three starter. Linda's hearing voices.
Yes.
First, how will this affect the cost of a Fenway Frank?
Yeah, you know, imagine sitting around with a bunch of friends and wondering how much it would cost to buy your favorite sports team. A good thing you're sitting down. We are, too, because the answer is going to knock you out. In a deal of staggering proportions, the Boston Red Sox have been sold to a group led by Florida Marlins owner John Henry, who is in the process of selling the Marlins, and former San Diego Padres owner Tom Werner. The price? $660 million, an amount that would double the previous record for a baseball club, which is the $323 million Larry Dolan paid for the Cleveland Indians just last year. This is an agreement that still needs to be approved by 75% of the 30 major league owners, an approval that is expected to go through.
I'm delighted to announce that the Boston Red Sox partners have voted unanimously this evening to sell 100% of the team's interest to the group led by John Henry, now subject to Major League Baseball approval. John Henry and Tom Werner and George Mitchell and Les Otten and Larry Lucchino are deeply involved and passionate about the game of baseball, and they're committed to our team. Moreover, they have the resources to continue our quest to beat the Yankees and to win a World Series here in Boston.
It's always about the Yankees and the quest to beat them for Boston. And if you live in Boston, root for the Red Sox, you truly understand. Here's a list of the largest sports franchise sales prices following approval. And when approved, the Henry Werner $660 million purchase will become the second highest all time behind the $800 million purchase of the Washington Redskins 2 years ago. Oh, by the way, with the purchase of the Red Sox, Tom Werner can now move to the East Coast to be closer to his girlfriend, $60 million woman, Katie Couric.
College hoop, Virginia, Georgetown, and D.C. for the first time since Ralph Sampson and Patrick Ewing. You remember way back then, 82-83 season, it was the game of the decade. Sampson dunking there, Ewing. Oh, the joyous 7-foot smash. Flash forward now. Thursday, Pete Gillen, fifth-ranked Virginia, hoping to win again as they did in that last trip to D.C. early in the first half. Wesley Wilson, that's Ewing-esque with the swat on Roger Mason Jr. Later in the first half, Virginia up 10, 21-11. Mason Jr., a little better that time, up and under. Use the rim to help you fend off the defender. Second half, Virginia up 34-24. J.C. Mathis, you're going to miss. Wahoo's big on the offensive board. Travis Watson playing rough. Virginia up 36-24. Later in the second, four-point game, Adam Hall drives, and there's Wilson again. He had six Watson this one. Tight ball game, 4 points, 55-51 with 4 minutes to play. Mason Jr. high off the window. He had 16, and Virginia will go on to win this one by 6, 61-55. Ralph, we think he was happy about that. Chris Williams, 17 points, 11 boards for Georgetown. Kevin Braswell, just 9 points, a 2 of 14 shooting. Ahoyas started slow, 9 points in the first 13 minutes. Cavs, 24th straight win versus a non-conference opponent. Tennessee Louisville, Buzz and Ricky coaching a good one in Freedom Hall. 70-64, we got drama late.
Volunteers by 6, final 35 seconds. Reese Gaines way out there. 15-3.
Just like that, we get a ball game knotted at 70. Marcus Haslip inside, he's got it, but son, don't celebrate too much.
5 seconds. Gaines, just for a three. Oh, yeah! 1.8 seconds to go.
Ah, the joy of the three-point shot. Last chance for Tennessee. Great pass. Haslip at one chance. Got a great look, couldn't hit the baby hook, and Louisville escaped 73-72. Gaines, who hit the game winner, finished with 22. The lead changed hands 4 times in the last 2:36. Seville, 0-for-12 from 3 the first 19 minutes of the second half, and then made all 3 of their long tosses in the final 60 seconds. Cards win streak now at 7.
On ESPN tonight, North Carolina State battled Pittsburgh in the Tangerine Bowl in Orlando. That's Antonio Bryant, the All-American listed as questionable, but he started. Hit up 10-3, first and 10, David Priestley. 17-31, 258 yards. Look at that over-the-shoulder catch by Antonio Bryant. Same drive, 3rd-and-1, Priestley. Bryant, 2 DB passes for Priestley. Bryant with 7 catches for 101 yards. That was in the first half alone. Now on the ensuing kickoff, Gregory Golden was just that. He had the Midas touch, returning this 90 yards for NC State for the score. So we have a ball game, folks. It was suddenly Wolfpack just down 17-10 against Pitt, who came in very hot. And then Phillip Rivers, ball popped loose after that hit by Lewis Moore, and Tyree Young takes advantage. Pitt Panthers, 6 straight wins. This is a team that started the season 1-5. For Pitt, their first bowl victory since the 89 Hancock Bowl. Yes, it's worth repeating. Pitt began the season 1-5, finishing the season on this great note, a 6-game win streak, to finish their season at 7-5. North Carolina State outgained by the Panthers, 430-315.
You think this is a soap opera, you're full of.
I'm sure people vomited in the stands when they watched our kicking game.
If it wasn't for cerebral reversal, I'd get like this.
Also ahead as we go inside the show, it's a stretch and they're realigning next year, but we'll show you something about the AFC Central that provides hope to the folks in Ohio. Plus, the promise of something special. Highlights of Vince Carter's night against the Bulls, not too long from right now on SportsCenter.
Love the promise. Also ahead, why a home date with the Saints is a must win in more ways than one for the Bucks Sunday. 2 words, playoffs. Plus, the scoop on why the Red Sox aren't just a 2-star team anymore, and more on the guy's footing the bill.
Yo. 2-6 packs and a big bag of ice sitting in the bite, but the brew tastes nice. Like to the stick it in the fridge, stick it in the fridge, stick it in the fridge, stick it in the fridge. Kind of thirsty.
Smash mouth football right up until kickoff.
A little football amongst friends. Sunday NFL Countdown. Sunday mornings at 11 Eastern. Only on ESPN.
This weekend, number 2 Maryland and their swingman Byron Mouton meet post-presence Aaron McGee and the 21st-ranked Sooners. Saturday, SportsCenter remembers, a tribute to athletes and other heroes of uniform who were lost in 2001. Later, the 7th-ranked Fighting Illini and Frank Williams face Kareem Rush on the 9th-ranked Missouri Tigers. On Sunday Night Football, Curtis Martin and the Jets need another big win when they battle Peyton Manning and the Colts. Catch ESPN News anytime for scores and updates.
Center is brought to you by McDonald's. We love to see you smile.
Well, it is a hugely important game involving New Orleans. Unfortunately for the Buccaneers, it's not the Super Bowl in New Orleans they're playing Sunday, but rather a regular season game against the Saints in Tampa. I guess that means no U2 concert at halftime. Bummer. Both the Bucs and Saints stand 7-6, tied for the sixth and final playoff spot in the NFC. After Sunday, there will not be a tie, and the winner will have a huge advantage. Mike Golic, buck up. Tampa Bay, this isn't your first time.
Once again, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers find their window of opportunity closing. But a must-win situation Sunday certainly is a position they're not unfamiliar with.
Call it buckball. here we are again, and I think we always have different intentions for what buckball should mean, but this is what it usually comes down to. And, you know, I wish we didn't keep having history repeat itself, but we've been successful in this position before.
For whatever reason, we can't seem to get that stigma of being against the wall out of us. And you never want to say you're putting yourself in that position on purpose, but I mean, when the time comes for us to get out of that situation, we just don't perform. So here we are again, and we got to get back out of it. We want to get to the playoffs.
Is there thoughts about not achieving what a lot of people thought you could, including yourself and Tony, and what his future may be?
People talk about it all the time. What's the future hold? Is, you know, Bill Parcells' room is running rampant in our press, at least. And you know, we don't worry about it. We know what the job Tony's doing, and yeah, he gets a lot of heat for it, but he knows it's on us.
You can't even get a vote of confidence from anybody about anything around here, except that we play Sunday at 1 o'clock. That's not a good situation to be in when you're the winningest coach in an organization. When you brought a full stadium and a half a stadium waiting to be filled. I don't understand that.
What the Bucs do understand is that their game Sunday against the Saints has a lot more than just the playoffs riding on it. Rondé Barber and Warren Sapp did not practice on Thursday, but both are expected to play Sunday. In Tampa, Mike Golic, ESPN.
Thank you, Mike. And don't forget, this is a Thursday promo for a special edition of Sunday NFL Countdown that will air on Saturday. Three huge games to talk about. Pats, Dolphins, battle for first in Foxborough, will a banged-up Jeff Garcia face the fierce and Philly blitz. And the Raiders set their sights on gaining home field advantage in the playoffs. From Chris Berman, Steve Young, Chris Mortensen for Sunday edition of NFL Countdown on Saturday. Very confusing. Just turn on your TV at 11:30 a.m. Eastern on ESPN. Roll the VCR. Coming up, a one-of-a-kind compilation of moments like this.
You think I'm a damn fool?
Okay, how lucky us. Also, a former Steeler reveals why this year's team could be a one-of-a-kind in its division.
0% APR financing has been extended at Rockenbach's Chevy Megastore in Grays Lake. Get 0% financing on all new vehicles, cars, trucks, vans, and sport utilities. Zero extended. Don't miss 0% financing on used vehicles. We've got more 0% vehicles in stock than any other dealer in Chicagoland. Choose from over 3,000 new and used vehicles every day. 0% has been extended at Rockenbach Chevrolet. Call 888 Fun Chevy today.
The power to be informed.
Several tornadoes are believed to have touched down across Chicagoland.
The power to get the news.
Well, Mayor Daley says a damage assessment is on.
Anytime. The power to be there when help is needed.
Seen an outpouring of support at blood centers all across the Chicagoland area.
CLTV, the power of news 24 hours.
Starting Friday, a marathon of Muhammad Ali, including Real Classics Uncut, a behind-the-scenes look at Will Smith and the making of Ali the movie. 25 hours of Muhammad Ali starts 8 p.m. Friday, only on ESPN Classic.
Hey, boys, what y'all doing?
Just out here checking these old fences.
Yeah, me too.
Hey, is that a dollar?
Yeah, it's on my side of the fence.
Wrong. That's on my side.
No, that's on my side.
It is on my side.
Guys, it's just a buck. Oh, yeah, with 10, 10, 220, all calls up to 20 minutes are 99 cents.
20 minutes for 99 cents?
And 7 cents a minute?
After 20.
Wow, that's cheap.
Guess he had to make a phone call. Call me.
Dial 10, 10, 220. This Christmas, Method Man and Red Man are going to Harvard. biggest holiday party ever.
You eat coals? I buy eat coals.
Ho.
I'm from Wisconsin. Ho. I got the munchies like a mother.
Ho.
Wait a minute, did you just call us ho?
Oh, no. I meant that in a good way.
Method Man, Red Man.
What's your name?
How High, rated R, at Theaters Friday.
2001, a year we'll never forget. From the tragedy and heroism of September 11th, to the passing of Dale Earnhardt, the inspirational life of Willie Stargell, and the memories of so many others. We'll celebrate them all Saturday night at 7 Eastern when SportsCenter remembers legends of 2001.
On the court, Memphis Temple. John Calipari, John Chaney, nothing but love. Coaches 11-11 all time against each other. 10 seconds left in the first half. Good. McFadden. McFadden, three of his 22. Tigers up 7 at the break. Second half, Antonio Burks to Dewan Wagner up top. Memphis up 35-31 later in the second half. Memphis still up a handful, and more Wagner. Goes off the dribble, up and in. Nice homecoming for Wagner. Memphis wins at 64-54.
You know, seeing John Calipari and John Chaney as opposing coaches tonight in the Memphis Temple game got us thinking about their classic confrontation a few years back, which then got us thinking that coaches, managers, for all we know, have been known to explode now and then.
Well, it's tough to carry the stress of an entire team. Please remember that these are grown adults making nice wages, something they clearly forgot. Trey Wingo, with 10 guys, has had even worse days than former Cubs manager Lee Elia.
We start with the master of the facial contortions, Purdue's Gene Cady, who also found ways to use his hands at this press conference after a game in 89.
I need to have a meeting with the coaches and referees in the room in April and say, the guy has your hand on you above the circle, it's a foul. And when they touch him, it's a foul. And when they get inside, start pushing each other and jamming each other,
here we find the normally mild-mannered Tommy Lasorda, except if you have bad recording equipment.
Hey, get them away from my mouth, will you, please? Okay? If you don't have a good enough tape recorder that it can record from here, then go buy a new one, okay? I don't want it stuck in my mouth.
Ah, sweet Lupinella. Unless, of course, a call you made went against him, or your name is Rob Dibble. At number 7, we begin the first of many compilation entries. Mike Ditka from his days in Chicago.
They got a pretty good defense, Red, and they stopped us.
You think this is a soap opera, you're full of...
To a classic press session in New Orleans.
There's three quarterbacks on this football team. Whichever one starts, starts. Whichever one don't, we'll back him up. Next.
Injury from the game.
Talk to the trainer. Next.
Mike, why are you in such a bad mood?
What do you care?
We were just as shocked at you that Bob Knight didn't make the top 5. Still, his multiple entries, too numerous to list in their entirety.
If it wasn't for cerebral reversal, I'd be here like this.
Who the hell told you I wasn't going to be here? I'd like to know. Do you have any idea who it was?
Yeah, I do, Coach.
Who?
I'll point them out to you in a while.
They were from Indiana, right?
No, they're not.
No, weren't from Indiana, and you didn't get it from anybody from Indiana, did you?
Please.
No, I'll handle this the way I want to handle it now that I'm here. You it up to begin with. Now just sit there or leave. I don't give a what you do.
In my entire adult life, I've never used the expression game face. So I've no idea what it means or what you're supposed to mean. We had a dressing room originally that would have been very, very cramped with 4 midgets.
The state of Indiana well represented here. Cady, Knight, and now the Colts' Jim Mora.
And get that on TV. I'm sure people vomited in the stands when they watched our kicking game. We couldn't do diddly poo offensively.
People are sick when they do something like that. Absolutely friggin' sick. We stink on defense. We stink. We stink.
We suck. The second half, we suck. Playoffs? Don't talk about playoffs. You kidding me? Playoffs?
Here now, Mike Milbury, and we should have known he'd make this list because as a Bruins player in 79, he actually went into the stands to beat a fan with his own penny loafer. And then as a Bruins coach, in between periods during a playoff game with Pittsburgh, this. We arrow the priest for added audio emphasis.
Just another day in the office, Dennis. Just take your paycheck and go home.
Staying in hockey and badgering officials, then Devils head coach Jim Schoenfeld with bakery battery at the expense of Don Kaharski. The holy grail of manager mayhem in baseball came in Kansas City with the Royals' Hal McRae. This one left one rider bloodied. And at number one, still the undisputed champion, Calipari and Cheney, with a license to thrill back in their days of being A-10 rivals.
And you pick them out here, single them out, you can't get that shit out of here to
peace on earth, goodwill towards men. Diamondbacks beat the Yankees again. First it was the seven-game World Series show, now it's David Wells. After flirting with his old employer, it appears the free agent lefty has instead decided on purple pinstripes. Wells will receive a one-year contract heavy on the incentives. 38-year-old starter still needs to pass the physical and work out a couple of contract points to complete the deal, but Jerry Colangelo says, we've agreed to agree. Also close on a relocation pact, Red Sox free agent Johnny Damon. 3 or 4 years and nearly $8 million a season. Boston needs a leadoff hitter and an outfielder to replace the recently traded Carl Everett. Damon is both of those things. Our new owners, who knows if it's his general manager, Dan Duquette's last move for the Red Sox. Damon declined salary arbitration with the A's. Didn't have the best season in Oakland, but a 1.5 raising his average to 256. He's 28, and as you can see, the guy decidedly a post-All-Star performer. Did hit 409 in 5 playoff games against the Yanks. Scored 100 runs or more for the 4th straight season. 108 last, and only the E-hero among leadoff hitters. The Red Sox, they've been busy, haven't they, Linda?
December 2000, the Red Sox signed superstar Manny Ramirez to a blockbuster contract worth $160 million.
We're proud to announce today that we have terms and Manny has signed an 8-year contract with the Red Sox.
December 2001, with the shadow of a late season collapse and a second place finish 13 and a half games behind the AL East champs, the New York Yankees, this offseason, a different story in Boston. November, the Sox took the first step toward reshaping their underachieving team. Boston cutting loose outfielder Troy O'Leary, as well as infielder John Valentin. Those moves cleared up nearly $11 million. Also gone, two-time Cy Young winner Brett Saberhagen and $6 million utility man Mike Lansing.
We had a number of free agents, became free agents, went back in the free agent pool, and we're going to take that money and reinvest it in players to help our ball club for next year, years going forward.
This future would not include troubled outfielder Carl Everett. The Sox trading the talented but volatile outfielder to the Rangers for starter Darren Oliver.
We expressed our interest and concerns to Carl, and when he didn't respond to those interests, we just thought it was better for the organization to make a trade for him to a new market.
Now that they had their lefty arm, the Sox dealt 3 minor leaguers to the Cardinals for right-handed pitcher Justin Hermanson. Hermanson 14-13 last year in St. Louis, matching a career high for wins, and he finished with a 4.45 ERA. wheeling and dealing wasn't over. Sox catcher Scott Hatteberg was traded to Colorado for two-time Gold Glove winner second baseman Reese. This was the second time Reese was traded in 2 days. And with a possible solution found in center field, Baltimore appears to be stronger up the middle.